and card vendors attempted to tax monies when people take it out of their own account.
A surprise visit by officials from the CPFSA led to the discovery of the abuse of 8 American boys being housed in Attitude Adjustment Facility in St. Elizabeth.
Vibes Cartel's attorney Iset Buchanan says there is no animosity between himself and the DPP, Paula Llewellyn.
You can call her about other matters that she has assisted me with. So the narrative that there is some animosity and all that, there is none whatsoever.
In news from the rest of the world, crisis-torn Haiti takes an important step towards appointing a new prime minister and restoring the rule of law.
The International Court of Justice orders Israel to allow unimpeded access of food aid to Gaza.
In headline sports, Ronaldo Walcott explains what it's like coaching the two fastest women alive.
And later in our broadcast, in our cover story at 5:35, Tax Administration Jamaica is blaming the onerous procurement guidelines for a situation which has caused it to spend hundreds of millions of dollars in taxpayers' money to rent properties it has yet to occupy. We'll be joined by TAJ's Commissioner General Ainsley Hugh Powell.
In public opinion at 6:26, we ask, bun and cheese or bun and fish? Give us your comments by logging onto our Facebook page, Nationwide News Network, and by tweeting us at Nationwide Radio, and message us on WhatsApp at 876-285-5693. You can also leave your comments on Instagram at Nationwide 90FM.
In the nation's business at 6:40, Labor Minister Pernell Charles Jr. will join us to explain why his ministry is taking on the idea of allowing parish councillors and even council caretakers to participate in the selection of beneficiaries under PATH.
And at 8, it's Jamaican Dads with Dennis Brooks, Garth Williams, Marlon Campbell and Floyd Green.
All these and more as we take you home on air on your mobile, Nationwide 90FM, Nationwide Radio JM.com, and on the Nationwide app available on Google Play and the App Store this Thursday afternoon, Holy Thursday, March 28, 2024.
News at 5 is brought to you by the new Crunch Sandwich from KFC. Available in hot and spicy or barbecue for just $600. A finger-licking good deal at KFC.
If it's news, it's got to be Nationwide 90FM.
Now to the details. The Jamaican economy grew by 2.6% for the calendar year 2023 when compared to 2022. That's according to the latest information from the Statistical Institute of Jamaica, Statin. The growth was driven primarily by gains in mining and tourism. Chevron Campbell tells us more.
According to Statin, for the fourth quarter of 2023, the Jamaican economy grew by 1.7%. That completed 11 consecutive quarters of economic growth since the country emerged from the worst of the COVID-19 pandemic. The goods-producing industries grew by 0.8%, while the services industries grew by 2%. On the goods-producing side, mining was the standout performer, expanding by 21.5%. This was followed by agriculture, which grew by 2.6% for the quarter. However, construction declined by 3.8%. Growth in the services industries was led by tourism, as represented by hotels and restaurants, which improved by 8.3%. All other segments of the services industries grew, with the exception of government services. Statin says preliminary estimates for the calendar year 2023 indicated that the economy expanded by 2.6%. This was due to annual growth in the services industries of 3%, and the goods-producing industries at 1.6%. Chevron Campbell for Nationwide News.
Government Senator Abka Fitzhenley is blasting as desperate and misleading the claim by PNP President Mark Golding and Opposition Senate Leader Peter Bunting that Jamaicans have been saddled with a heavy tax burden by the Holness administration. Senator Fitzhenley says the argument is elementary and a sign of the opposition's worsening thirst for power. Robian Williams has more.
During his contribution to the budget debate recently, opposition leader Mark Golding sought to discredit the government's declaration that it has imposed no new taxes on Jamaicans over the past 7 years. In contesting the claim, Golding reasoned that revenue collection has increased by $419 billion since 2021. He said this is evidence that Jamaicans have been exposed to additional taxes by successive wholeness administrations since 2016. Golding's argument was repeated by opposition Senate leader Peter Bunting on Wednesday during his contribution to the debate on the appropriations bill. Senator Abka Fitz-Henley, who was among government lawmakers who voted in favor of the bill, says the argument put forward by Bunting and Golding is not only misleading, but disappointing.
The fact of the matter is that the government of Jamaica has managed the economy so well that the economy continues to expand and there is greater efficiency in the revenue collection mechanisms in place. And therefore, the numbers have gone up, continue to increase. This argument that because the revenue numbers are increasing or have increased significantly over the past few years means that automatically new taxes have been imposed. It's a basic argument. It's an elementary argument I hear being advanced by Messrs. Bunting and Golding.
Senator Fitz-Henley says the fact that the opposition is seeking to attribute an increase in revenues to new taxes amounts to nothing more than desperation politics.
Here are two gentlemen who are so desperate for political power that they are prepared to use convolution and misleading arguments to achieve that objective. That's the kind of leadership that Jamaican people voted out in the past and are not willing to countenance, in my view.
Fitz-Henley says the PNP has no moral authority to lecture this JLP administration about taxation policy.
The PNP understands that they did wrong by the Jamaican people. These are folks who tax parties, impose a levy on handcart vendors, attempted to tax monies when people take it out of their own account. They understand that the Jamaican people won't forget those transgressions and they are seeking to put forward basic, elementary, and convoluted talking points to mislead the people into believing that the government's good management of the economy is due to some onerous measure imposed on the people of Jamaica. But I know that the people of Jamaica are intelligent, they're savvy, they're discerning, and they won't be fooled.
Robian Williams for Nationwide News.
Opposition Senator Damian Crawford believes the true level of productivity in the country is not being reported given the flawed nature of the approach being used to capture it. Senator Crawford made the argument during his contribution to the debate on the appropriations bill in the upper house on Wednesday.
The productivity conversation is somewhat misplaced in Jamaica because we fail to acknowledge that service economies often report lower productivity. In economics, it's called the Baumol disease. The Baumol disease says the characteristics of service cause for it to find difficulty in productivity. Let us look at one characteristic, perishability. The service ends when the person leaves. So therefore, if you are working in Don's factory, you can make your 10 for the day. And you can store 5 if 5 don't sell. The hotel don't have that capacity. If the room don't full tonight, it just don't full tonight. It can't store it for tomorrow. That reduces the productivity.
Senator Crawford says Prime Minister Andrew Holness has repeatedly called for greater productivity, especially in the public sector. During his contribution to the recent budget debate, the Prime Minister cited higher levels of productivity as the antidote to the eroding effect that inflation has on wages. Senator Crawford says the problem lies in the manner in which productivity is currently measured in Jamaica's increasingly service-oriented economy.
If we're going to really look upon the productivity conversation, we might need to look at the structure of our economy to maybe shift to some level of manufacturing and other things that don't have the Baumol disease. This is a global conversation. So therefore, it is a, and I am not suggesting that there's not need for productivity gains. I'm saying if the economy continue to do more hotels and more services, we are going to have a fight to get those productivity gains. And so therefore the structure of the economy will impact on the measured productivity because of that.
Senator Damian Crawford.
Attorney at law Isaac Buchanan says there's no animosity between himself and the Director of Public Prosecutions DPP, Paula Llewellyn. This follows his 2-year suspension from the legal profession by the disciplinary panel of the General Legal Counsel GLC last December. The Court of Appeal has granted a stay of the GLC's decision pending an appeal by Buchanan. Buchanan pleaded guilty to professional misconduct after directing profane and sexually explicit lyrics from dancehall artist Vybz Kartel towards the DPP. The attorney also made disparaging comments about Justice Minister Delroy Chuck. Speaking during an interview on the popular Let's Be Honest podcast, hosted by Jay Frass, Buchanan says he has no beef with the DPP.
Prosecutors prosecute. You cannot blame people for doing their jobs. Even whatever decision that she would have made, she said she did it within her wisdom. She said it was a gamble. That's the gamble that she took. It's an executive decision. She's a creature of the Constitution, and she used her office to do what she did within her wisdom. And she has an open door policy. You can call her about other matters that she has assisted me with. So the narrative that there is some animosity and all of that, there is none whatsoever. She does her work. I think generally women with high authority, they get criticism. Just look at the Speaker of the House. She gets a lot of rap for being the Speaker of the House.
Buchanan maintains that the comments he made and lyrics he quoted were in keeping with the nature of the show he was on at the time.
Context matters. Context matters. Do I encourage people to disrespect a woman generally? No, because context matters and the nature of the show that I was on, the ability to use English language and literature and understanding societal context, I'm going to leave it at that. I paid my $500,000 and I got my RADAM, my 2-year suspension.
Isaac Buchanan, attorney at law. An unannounced welfare check was what tipped off the authorities to the abuse being suffered by 8 American boys at the Atlantis Leadership Academy in St. Elizabeth. That's according to the Child Protection and Family Services Agency, CPFSA. 7 of the boys are now in the care of the agency. More in this report from Shalois Michael.
Atlantis Leadership Academy is located in Treasure Beach, St. Elizabeth. The boarding school advertises itself as a faith-based institution that caters to teenagers struggling with substance abuse, anxiety disorders, and defiant behavior. The institution was catering to 8 American boys aged 14 to 18. On February 8, the CPFSA, along with representatives from the U.S. Embassy in Kingston, made a surprise visit to the institution where they observed signs of abuse and neglect of the boys in question. The boys were subsequently removed from the facility and the matter reported to the police. 7 of the boys are now being kept in residential child care facilities after a court order granted the CPFSA temporary care amid the investigation. CEO of the CPFSA, Laurette Adams-Thomas, says the boys are receiving psychotherapeutic support.
The priority of the CPFSA is the well-being of these children while they are in Jamaica. The children have undergone medical assessments and are generally in good health, receiving ongoing care. This includes specialized psychotherapeutic support and occupational therapy.
The other student, an 18-year-old, who was too old for his hearing to be done in the children's court jurisdiction, was safely returned to the U.S. in February in coordination with his family and the U.S. Embassy. Mrs. Adams-Thomas says efforts are being made to return the other boys to their families.
We are also collaborating with the International Social Services, that's ISS USA, for the safe reintegration of these teens with their families.
Mrs. Adams-Thomas says the matter will return to court in April.
The CPFSA will return to court on the 3rd of April to provide an update on the home studies being conducted and to receive any further instructions from the court.
Efforts to contact Atlantis Leadership Academy remain futile. In the meantime, the CPFSA is reminding the public to report any suspicions of child abuse through its 24-hour hotline 211. They can also send a WhatsApp message to 876-878-2882 or visit any CPFSA parish office. Reports can also be made via social media at CPFSAJM on Instagram, Facebook, and X. Shalois Michael for Nationwide News.
Meanwhile, the Atlantis Leadership Academy has been accused of meting out abuse to awards that have gone through its behavior modification programs over time. That's according to WWASP Survivors, a group of persons who've been through such facilities. Kimon Thompson has our story.
WASP Survivors is run by the alumni of programs, boot camps, and boarding schools operated by the Worldwide Association of Specialty Programs and Schools and their affiliates. According to their online forum, Atlantis Leadership Academy has been listed among several institutions with a reputation for abusing the troubled teens taken there for behavior modification. In a 2019 post, the forum says the Atlantis owner, Randall Cook, is himself a former student of a troubled teen program, one which was closed by the Samoan government after a series of child abuse claims. The post accused Atlantis of cruelty and unusual punishment of the teens in its care, and linked it to the Tranquility Bay program, which was shut down in 2009 amid claims of abuse. In response, a user identified as Randall Cook confirmed participation in the Samoa program and later employment with WASP. The post said there had only been one report of abuse at Atlantis at the time and called it a unique circumstance. The post by Randall Cook also said, quote, "We can't be everything to everyone. We just do our best, which ultimately turns out to be pretty awesome. I support having a watchdog out there, as there are many programs that should not be in existence and many staff that should not even be within driving distance of said programs," end quote. The Atlantis website says the campus culture is a balanced atmosphere of accountability, personal health, hard work, service to others, and leadership. It says the boys are instilled with values of integrity, forgiveness, compassion, and patience. It says, too, that Atlantis positively changes a teen's trajectory in life, helping young men restart their lives and in turn reconnect and become whole and healthy with their families. Nationwide has placed numerous calls to Atlantis using the number on its website. We have yet to get an answer. Kimon Thompson, Nationwide News.
You're listening to the news on Nationwide 90 FM. More news after these.
Value Drug Pharmacy offers curbside pickup and delivery of your branded and generic drugs. WhatsApp your prescription to 876-881-6695. The time by Value Drug Pharmacy is
18 minutes past 5.
Rentokil Initial offers air purification solutions with triple filtration and unique auto-sensing capabilities that neutralizes malodor and replaces it with clean air. Call Rentokil Initial at 926-4236 for more details.
The temperature by Rentokil is
29 degrees Celsius in Kingston and also out west in Montego Bay.
Real estate dealers and salesmen, this year's licensing period is almost here. Skip the hassle and take advantage of the Real Estate Board's new direct online client portal payment platform. Go to our client portal and create an account to get started. Whether you're paying license fees, penalties, or continuing professional development courses, status notifications give you the peace of mind that your payments were successful. And emails with meeting links for your courses. Use the Real Estate Board's new client portal payment platform. Get on with the business of turning houses into homes.
Continuing the news, the Minister of Labour and Social Security, Pernell Charles Jr., says the ministry will consider allowing parish councillors and council caretakers to be part of the process to select families for PATH. The ministry's position follows a question raised at a forum on Wednesday by a caretaker for the Independence City Division in St. Catherine, Junior Gale. Mahiri Stewart has that report.
Junior Gale used a forum on Wednesday to highlight problems he had with the application process for PATH.
Persons in my division has vent their anger and asked me to speak on their behalf. One is the low life of living, life standard that you have to meet in order to be qualified for PATH. Persons that come in the field, they do something different from what you say. I'm telling you, they expect you to be using a chimney, a pit toilet, a single bed with three pitney. They may speak to fire cook pan hood fire. And these are modern days.
Mr. Gale also recommended to Minister Charles that counselors play a role in the selection of PATH beneficiaries.
I think councillors, not Member of Parliament, councillors and councillor caretakers should be given privileges as to where selection of PATH beneficiaries are concerned, instead of just a computer with an algorithm or whatever you said. Because we as councillor caretaker and councillor, we know the people more than a computer and even more than the MP. So we should be given some privilege to choose or to recommend those persons.
Minister Charles, in response to the first query, highlighted that no person can be rejected from PATH for possessing assets such as basic appliances. He says questions are asked in order to give workers an idea of the situation surrounding each applicant.
Does having a washing machine, a stove, a fridge make an applicant ineligible to receive PATH benefits? If you have those things, does it mean you cannot get on PATH? The answer to that is no. However, if you have a stove, if you have a fridge, if you have all of those things, those are part of what is considered to determine whether or not you are fit for the program or not. We want to make sure that the revision of the program doesn't leave anybody with any confusion. We have to ask these questions in order to find out whether or not somebody is deserving of that support. But we hear you.
Minister Charles says the idea of allowing elected officials in municipal corporations across the island to participate in the selection process for PATH is not a bad one.
The second thing you mentioned about councillors, I'm gonna take your recommendation. And it will be put to the group that is dealing with it. I can tell you, however, that many persons may say to you, members of parliament, councillors and others, maybe they're not the best persons to choose PATH applicants. Maybe we should leave it to the social workers so that you don't have a feeling of politics being involved.
Yes, most definitely.
Or maybe you should have both MPs and councillors. So whatever it is that we come up with, the goal is to try to make sure that it's as objective as possible.
Mahiri Stewart for Nationwide News.
World in a Minute is brought to you by ABC Electrical Sales. We make things as easy as ABC. Hose Assembly and Supply, equipping Jamaica for success.
Charles O'Connor Consulting Limited, COCN, driven by international accounting standards, modern technology, and integrity.
The World in a Minute.
Members of Haiti's Transitional Presidential Council have pledged to restore public and democratic order in the country. The pledge was signed by 8 members of the 9-member council, a clear signal the council may soon assume its official duties. Among its first acts will be to appoint a new prime minister. The council members noted that as soon as they are officially installed, they would help put Haiti back on the path of democratic legitimacy, stability, and dignity. The pledge comes nearly a month after gangs began targeting key government infrastructure across the capital, Port-au-Prince.
The International Court of Justice has ordered Israel to allow unimpeded access to food aid into Gaza. This amid reports that tens of thousands of people are facing imminent starvation. A panel of judges at the UN's top court issued the legally binding order by unanimous decision. The judges say Palestinians in Gaza were facing worsening conditions of life with famine and starvation spreading rapidly.
World in a Minute was brought to you by ABC Electrical Sales. We make things as easy as ABC. Hose Assembly and Supply, equipping Jamaica for success.
Charles O'Connor Consulting Limited, COCN, driven by international accounting standards, modern technology, and integrity.
Recapping the top stories making the nationwide news at this hour, Statin says the Jamaican economy grew by 2.6% for the calendar year 2023. It also says the Jamaican economy completed an unprecedented 11 straight quarters of GDP expansion in the fourth quarter last year.
Government Senator Abka Fitzhenley says the opposition PNP has no moral authority to lecture this JLP administration about tax policy.
These are folks who tax parties, impose a levy on hand card vendors, attempted to tax monies when people take it out of their own account.
Vibes Cartel's attorney Iset Buchanan says there is no animosity between himself and the DPP, Paula Llewellyn.
You can call her about other matters that she has assisted me with. So the narrative that there is some animosity and all that, there is none whatsoever.
My name is George Davis.
And I'm Robian Williams.
You can find the news on our website at nationwideradiojm.com and on the Nationwide app, available on Google Play and the App Store. News Next, headlines at 6.
News at 5 was brought to you by the new Crunch Sandwich from KFC. Available in hot and spicy or barbecue for just $600. A finger-licking good deal at KFC.
We've been a part of everyday Jamaican life for over 25 years. From paydays to birthdays, unexpected emergencies to anniversary celebrations, the supermarket checkout line, or paying a bill or taxes on time. Our fast, secure debit network provides reliable service so you can always depend on Multilink. Jamaican and proud. Fast, secure, everywhere.
Sports at 5 is brought to you by Total Tools. They almost always have it.
Hello, good afternoon, and welcome to sports here on Nationwide 90FM. I'm Wayne Walker. Jamaica lost by 7 wickets to the Windward Islands at Liberta today. In the second round of games in the West Indies Rising Stars under 15 cricket competition, Tyson Gordon, 51, and Ryan Littleton, 61, top scored for Jamaica in their 193-8. The Windwards replied with 198-3 with 10 overs to spare as Ayesheen Fontaine slammed an impressive 93 to lead the victory charge against Littleton, who grabbed a 2-for-28. Over at Bethesda, Barbados crushed the Leeward Islands by 94 runs. The Bajans piled up 327-4 on the back of a century 105 from DJ Wiggins and Jahidi Hines, 81. The Leewards replied with 233 all out. Only LaShawn Bergan, 50, and Josh Edwards made any useful contribution. Over at Coolidge, the defending champions Trinidad and Tobago lost by 9 wickets to Guyana. Arif Khan grabbed the 5-for-18 as TNT was kittled out for 83 in 24 overs. Guyana easily achieved victory with 84-1 in 18 overs. The competition continues on Saturday with Jamaica facing Guyana at Bethesda. Jamaica's opening game was a no result against the Leeward Islands because of rain. Cricket West Indies is set to unveil its new four-year strategic plan for 2024-2027 titled The Long Run, recently presented to the board of directors during a board meeting in Antigua and discussed with the shareholders at the annual general meeting. This strategic blueprint marks a pivotal juncture for the organization and West Indies cricket. The Long Run will outline key objectives and initiatives aimed at fostering growth, sustainability and excellence in cricket. It will encompass measures to enhance governance, player development, grassroots programs, fan engagement, and the commercial partnerships aligning with CWI's overarching vision to elevate West Indies cricket in the region and on the global stage. The strategic plan, developed internally, represents a collaborative effort by the Cricket West Indies management team. It includes extensive consultations and valuable insights from staff and players. Coach of Elite Performance Track Club Ronaldo Walcott says it has been a joy training two of the world's fastest female athletes. Walcott is in charge of conditioning reigning Olympic double sprint champ Elaine Thompson-Herah and her predecessor Shellyann Fraser-Pryce. Thompson-Herah is hoping to defend her 100-200 meter titles, while Fraser-Pryce is hoping to add another gold medal to those that she's already picked up in Beijing 2008 and London 2012. And Walcott says he doesn't have to do much to motivate the sprinters.
Persons who have achieved a lot, they tend to be very, very focused. So it's way easier to work with mature athletes and younger athletes sometimes, or most times, because they're goal-driven. They understand what it means to be successful, and they understand what to do to become successful. So What I get on a day-to-day basis is an Elaine who is hungry, an Elaine who is willing to do whatever I ask of her. And it's the same thing with Shelly-Ann. And I would have had the experience with Shelly-Ann first where, okay, I don't have to tell her to do something twice. Matter of fact, she's probably going to be the one who's going to nudge me. Hey, coach, what are we going to do tomorrow? What's the plan for tomorrow? It's just so hungry, despite the success that's there before.
That's Ronaldo Walcott, coach of Shelly and Fraser Price and Elaine Thompson here. That's sports. We're going to be back, though, at 6:05 with much more.
Sports at 5 was brought to you by Total Tools. They almost always have it.
Hyundai, the home of modern, premium, affordable vehicles. Call us at 876-630-1511. The time by Hyundai is
5:30.
Never before in our history has there been more roads built or under construction at the same time. The Maypen to Williamsfield Highway, the Montego Bay Perimeter Road, the South Coast Highway Improvement Project, and many more. We are building Jamaica.
The temperature by the office of the Prime Minister is
29 degrees Celsius here in Kingston and over in the West Montego Bay.
If you are a parliamentarian or a public official listed in the Jamaica Gazette December 5, 2023 regarding the Integrity Commission Act, or a public official receiving emoluments of $12 million or more during the period January 1, 2023 to December 31, 2023, you must file your statutory declarations as at December 31, 2023 and any outstanding statutory declarations on or before March 31. Download the updated statutory declarations form from the Integrity Commission's website at integrity.gov.jm/statutory-declarations. Ask your Human Resource or Administration Division for further information. A message from the Integrity Commission.
When someone is on top of things, it shows. On top of the day, on top of the game, on top of the world. And no other card puts you in charge like your new VM Visa credit card. Every click, insert, tap, or swipe solves a problem, sweetens a moment, and unlocks rewards. So what puts you in control of purchases, payments, and a global platform of perks? This card can. Get your VM Visa Gold or Visa Platinum credit card today. For more information, visit myvmgroup.com or call us at 876-754-8627.
Know your numbers and take control.
Message from the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
KFC!
The new crunch sandwich from KFC. Great flavor, great price, it's for me. KFC signature, hot and spicy. Chicken with the lettuce, mayo, fries and Pepsi. We've got you covered when you're hungry. The new crunch sandwich from KFC. We've got you covered when you're hungry. The new crunch sandwich from KFC.
Hungry for deals? Get the new crunch sandwich combo from KFC. A small hot and spicy chicken sandwich with lettuce and mayo, plus fries and a Pepsi. For just $600. Also available in barbecue. A finger-licking good deal. KFC.
Go crazy for this offer from Flo. Get a free Samsung phone and earbuds when you sign up for Flo Yard and Road for the special price of $4,999 plus GCT. Free is all the craze. This crazy offer won't last long. Visit discoverflo.co or your nearest Flo store for more info. Conditions apply.
Stand out among competitors. Show your commitment to quality. Submit your entry in the Bureau of Standards Jamaica National Quality Awards Program. Your entry provides the opportunity for a free comprehensive assessment of your organization's management system and facilitates improvement in effectiveness and efficiency. This prestigious award associates your organization with performance excellence. Step into a world of excellence. Gain access to international markets. Enter today.
Call 618-1534. The Bureau of Standards Jamaica, making standards work for you.
A time to double up your savings. These are the boost that you've been awaiting. Put in the words, the dreams you've been chasing. Double up your savings. Double up.
Save so you can win in the JN Bank Double Up Your Savings promotion. You could be one of five lucky quarterly winners to walk away with double the money you put in your savings account. Conditions apply.
Double up your savings.
Check our website and social media for details. JN Bank will help you find a way. Authorized under Section 58(3) of the Betting, Gaming and Lotteries Act.
bun to me cheese, bun to me cheese.
Give me yummy,
bun to me cheese, bun to me cheese.
Give me yummy,
don't stop at just a one slice, please. No other bun, perfect for
give me.
Me
yummy.
For real Jamaican flavor and quality for sure this Easter. Make yummy the bun to your cheese.
Yummy!
Give me yummy,
yummy.
Give me yummy, for Easter. Yummy bunzita, yummy for me family. Yummy for me, sir. Bun to me cheese, bun to me cheese.
Give me yummy,
bun to me cheese.
Bun to me cheese,
best bun.
Give me yummy.
But is this real? Hey Greg, come look at this. Oh my, it's happening. Mr. Daniels, the numbers keep getting bigger and bigger.
Sir, the clicks are off the charts.
Hello, sales. What's the emergency? 9,000 clicks in one day? 3,000 order? So how much we have left? What? I'll soon call you back. Mr. Nakamoto, it's Danny from Jamaica. I need 5,000 of the big ones. We're back in business.
Yes, sir. Arigato. Sweat it.
Amplify your brand. Let Nationwide 90FM assist you in tapping into a captivated audience across our social media platforms. For more information, contact us at 876-630-1210 or sales@nationwidenewsnetwork.com. Businesses, companies, and entrepreneurs, let's supercharge your brand.
You deserve a beautiful home. Join the expert Karen Booker, your design diva, this and every Saturday at 1 to 2 p.m. here on Nationwide 90FM. Learn what's really behind the design. Access insights and hacks that'll have your home looking like it was snatched from a magazine cover. From cushions to curtains, choosing colors to carpets, Karen will teach you the secret of the pros. That's the Design Studio every Saturday at 1 p.m. here on Nationwide 90.
Cover Story is brought to you by
Multilink. Roll with control. Use Multilink. Safe, fast, and accepted in more locations.
We've been a part of everyday Jamaican life for over 25 years. From paydays to birthdays, unexpected emergencies to anniversary celebrations, the supermarket checkout line, or paying a bill or taxes on time. Our fast, secure debit network provides reliable service so you can always depend on Multilink. Jamaican and proud. Fast, secure, everywhere.
...5:38 on this Thursday afternoon. Holy Thursday, March 28, 2024. This is the Nationwide Cover Story. My name is George Davis.
And I'm Siobhan Campbell.
How are you, sir?
Doing quite well.
Got your bun and cheese in the bag?
Yes, just earlier today.
Very well, sir. You eat bun and cheese?
Not really, but my family enjoys it. So it'll be passed on to my mother.
Bun and cheese or bun and fish?
I don't even know how you come up with that abomination about bun and fish.
Sir, what kind of nation? What kind of nation?
Abomination.
Oh my gosh. Well, Tax Administration Jamaica is blaming onerous procurement guidelines for the significant cost and time overruns that occurred in the leasing of certain properties. According to an Auditor General's report tabled in Parliament on Tuesday, the TAJ spent in excess of $350 million over 3 years, despite not occupying the buildings. Robian Williams tells us more.
Auditor General Pamela Monroe Ellis, in her report, noted that up to August 31, 2023, the TAJ expended nearly $372 million for the properties it had yet to occupy. The Auditor General says the TAJ's standard operating procedures are not consistent with best practices of accountability and transparency. However, the TAJ in response blames those same accountability measures for the lengthy and costly delays. TAJ says the government procurement policies require a lease to be in place before commencing the process to procure technical service and renovation of properties. Once the lease is in place, then TAJ is liable to make payments. The administration says the delay in occupancy is attributed to the lengthy procurement process and build-out required to make the space suitable for the delivery of services. In the instance of the property located in Mandeville, Manchester, the process had to be restarted and both are still ongoing. TAJ says in one instance, the procurement process for renovating the space for such a size lease requires cabinet's approval and a consultant to manage the project. It therefore means two separate procurement processes are required, which cumulatively can take up to 14 months for completion. In addition to the lengthy time frame for the process, the TAJ says the procurement for the building contractor failed on the basis that four additional contractors responded to TAJ's invitation for bids before the date for return of bids elapsed. In its response to the Auditor General, the TAJ outlined the lengthy and detailed procurement process it undertook starting in December 2020. However, it says, based on current timelines, the Anatobe Tax Office should be open for business at the new location within the second quarter of the 2024-25 fiscal year. It says the TAJ remains committed to observing the requirements of the government procurement policy as it works to provide suitable accommodations for customers and staff. Robian Williams for Nationwide News.
Thank you, Robian. Well, we're turning now to the Commissioner General of Tax Administration Jamaica, Ainsley Hugh Powell, for a response. Good evening, sir. Hello?
Hello. Yes. Good afternoon. Are you hearing me?
Yes, good afternoon. Are you hearing us loud and clear?
Yes, I am.
Good.
I'm getting a slight feedback, but I'm here.
Okay, good. All right, let's see if we can adjust that on our end. All right, Mr. Powell, so here we are. This news hit the airwaves coming out of the Auditor General's report tabled earlier this week. And a lot has been said since, including from TAJ with a 7-page press release on Wednesday. We invited you here because we wanted you to articulate for those who aren't understanding how the TAJ could find itself in this position hundreds of millions of dollars later.
Okay, all right. Let me just start with the conclusion and the recommendation, and then I'll try and build it out from there. Okay, we are pretty much, and you probably see it in the what was tabled, the report. We took on board what they had suggested. What we were attempting to do with the press release was to bring some clarification and not necessarily shifting or putting blame elsewhere. So what we went by and guided by was that the TAJ, based on funds already expended, tax administration must urgently put in place necessary arrangements for timely completion and the renovation of projects to reduce the level of nugatory expenditure, especially at the Anatobe location, given the safety concerns at the current office. So what we're trying to do in our release is to explain how we found ourselves down the wicket with that many months passing and rent being paid. When we seek to get a place to utilize our tax office, we rarely can get a fit and proper space that we can move in ready with him. We have to make certain changes. We have to put vaults. We have to put in cashier counters, structured cabling, etc., and that can take a little while. So by going through the process now to engage persons to do those, we had, in the case of the Mandeville office, we had the challenge of starting over twice. Right? And what we have done since this audit and the recommendations, because they would have given it to us before, which they normally do, and we have now try to marshal things to get things going to have persons into the space.
Mr. Paul, I hate to interrupt you, but just hold the line. We have to take the break. Let's take the break early so you can have an unfettered run on the other side. This is Nationwide.
Of action. Arise. It is time to arise into your greatness. Join us on Saturday, March 30, at the Summit House, formerly Knutsford Court Hotel, for the inaugural staging of the Women of Action Arise 2024 conference. Prepare to be uplifted as you make your way to the summit at 16 Chelsea Avenue in Kingston, or doors open at 8:30 a.m. and admission is free. Men, come and support the women. Come out and hear Reverend Mary Wildish, Brother Locksley Smith, and others. Women of Action Arise, powered by HR Outsourcing Solutions, Cumex Wealth Management, Tony's Toys Automotive Center, and Shekinah Trading. Women of Action Arise, Saturday, March 30, 2024.
Importers, the Jamaica Customs Agency is revolutionizing your clearance experience as our contactless clearance process becomes mandatory on April 2, 2024. This process will facilitate the clearance of all non-commercial personal shipments at our seaports with a CIF value of less than $5,000 being inspected by customs without you or your agent present. You're encouraged to make your payments using our customs mobile app, JA Customs Connect. Fees payable to your shipping agent and warehouse operator remain applicable. For further information, contact your freight forwarder or email contactlessclearance@jca.gov.jm or call 876-922-5140 to 8. The JCA's contactless clearance process is convenient, efficient, and secure. Jamaica Customs, keeping our customers in focus.
When someone is on top of things, it shows. On top of the day, on top of the game, on top of the world. And no other card puts you in charge like your new VM Visa credit card. Every click, insert, tap, or swipe solves a problem, sweetens a moment, and unlocks rewards. So what puts you in control of purchases, payments, and a global platform of perks? This card can. Get your VM Visa Gold or Visa Platinum credit card today. For more information, visit myvmgroup.com or call us at 876-754-8627.
Hello?
Nadine?
Yeah?
Me just pick up one Maxfield Easterbun up by supermarket phone.
One Maxfield, but nah go do.
Nadine, that is all I could afford.
Uncle Pat, Daddy, and Jeffrey only eat bun back. And bun only come with front back and back. So where next back I go come from?
If you want more Maxfield Easterbun, go up at the supermarket or check MaxfieldBakery.com.
Yeah, I forgot to send credit for put on service then.
Come on for me phone. Sure.
Maxfield Easterbun. Tweet to the max.
Good afternoon. You're listening to The Cover Story, where we're discussing the matter of the Tax Administration Jamaica's leasing of several properties, which raised some concerns with the Auditor General, as in hundreds of millions in overrun and time expended despite the properties not yet being occupied. We have with us the Commissioner General of TAJ, Ainsley Hugh Powell, who was explaining to us the context in which the TAJ responded to some of the concerns raised by the Auditor General, noting the lengthy and sometimes onerous procurement process. Sir Hugh Powell, can you continue?
Okay, thanks. The point I was trying to bring to the fore is that we, in our procedures, try and as best as possible to keep to and adhere to the procurement rules. So we would have, for instance, picked up how we could have improved on it. So, for instance, the Christiana construction at this time, we have applied some of that experience. So that is on track, for instance. The payments are up to date within cost, and the building is at the point where it ought to be. Right. So the other issue that I just wanted to raise, why we raised it, and to bring some clarification on the question of the procedure in terms of how did we acquire the property by getting an independent valuation. That was as a result of us getting some advice from the NLA that being a statutory body, TAJ did not necessarily have to come to them for approval or for valuation of property, right? So we went ahead and we did that. Now, there's a lot of debate around who is owner of the property. we started to try and acquire that property prior to the acquisition by a firm. So we were trying to see...
Hold on, Mr. Paul. Let's fill in the gaps for the listeners. So we have been told through the Auditor General's report that that property is owned by the Member of Parliament for Southeast St. Mary, Dr. Norman Dunn. You're saying that the process to acquire the property predates Dr. Dunn's ownership of said property.
Yes. And if you notice in their conclusions and recommendations, they accepted that that was above board, if I may use that term. I'd probably shoot people from it what they had said and you know, quote them directly. But we were pursuing the acquisition or possible acquisition of that property because we had to move out of where we were. It really and truly a building that has served its time. And some of the issues that we felt as tax auditors looking on, those were confirmed after the last earthquake because in the engineering report, they told us that some of the damages that were there were basically in a state, you know, an extension on what was there before a structural issue. And so we needed to move. Now, that corridor has a peculiarity to it. It's a long stretch, and taxpayers have to be moving between Port Maria, Anata Bay, Buff Bay, and Port Antonio. When we close an office in that area, it creates a lot of disruption.
Mm-hmm.
And if you speak to, for instance, persons in Junction, they will tell you they want a tax office there because they want to reduce the cost of going to Santa Cruz.
Yeah.
Armand,
so here's the thing, Mr. Powell. I don't think anybody sensible would even question the need for the tax office in that location. Nobody's questioning it. But here's the thing.
So when we reach...
Hold on. Yeah, here's how this reads. Here's how this reads. Going through the TAJ statement sent on Wednesday and having as my reference the Auditor General's comments about the two properties in Mandeville and in St. Mary. Basically, what the TAJ is saying, that to the tune of $300 million, because we had to, we are bound to follow the government procurement guidelines.
Yes.
We could not have avoided the position that we have found ourselves in. $300 million down and yet to occupy the building. Is that what you're saying? That no matter what you did, because you had to follow the rules and follow the process, you had to have been in this position?
Yes, because when we had the recommendation that we have to start over, we made sure we did, because we didn't want to go ahead outside of those requirements.
Just to be clear, the NLA, you said you turned to you got some advice from the National Land Agency.
Yes.
I want to be clear. Was that advice, or did that advice prove to be bad advice, which caused you to lose time, i.e. lose more money?
Well, we would have to probably say that we shouldn't have gone down that road, because when you look at the findings of the Auditor General, they are of the view that we should have still gone to the agency for the valuation.
So it turns out to have been bad advice.
Well,
if you won't say it, I'll say it. I understand the position you're in. But it was bad advice. It proved so at the end. And that cost additional time, and additional time in these circumstances mean additional monies.
Yes, because remember, as we said in the statement, we have to start enter into the lease arrangement, and normally that will require upfront payment of the monthly lease. You may get a a period that you might not have any, but you normally not going to get an extensively long period. And then the process to go and get a consultant, so this is design work, to scope the work, etc. Those things tend to come in a linear manner, and it would take us down a particular path.
Sir Powell, the one thing I'm not clear on is the need to restart the procurement process because additional bidders joined at a later date.
Right.
Were you not empowered to say, well, no, we really need to move forward?
Yeah. I think there might have been a little bit of a misunderstanding in the news clip that you did prior to starting the conversation. what really happened there was that on the site, there are recommended contractors. And when we started out, we saw four persons listed on the site. And those four persons were invited by us to put in their bid, which I think they did. However, it was subsequently discovered that there are other persons who had approval that were not listed on the site at the time when we were going through the process. And therefore, we had to go back. And it was a case where the consultant had advised us on that, but what the position was that the provision that we were relying on to might not have been the best provision in the procurement requirement. And so we had to go back and redo it, ask persons to come back into the bidding process. Now we are at that stage now. We have started the process of making selection.
When you had both projects on paper, Mr. Powell,
yes.
And you and your team looked at it. I mean, you've built out tax office space before. It's nothing new. There are people in the island who offer those services. Those services are nothing new. You don't need an alien to provide those services. The time it has taken so far to get to this point, was that the time you projected it to take at conception?
No. We didn't necessarily have that as our outcome in terms of time. Well, we're going for a shot at that.
But hold on. But the procurement rules, when you started the conceptualization, are the same as the procurement rules as they are now, and the procurement rules that attended to the process that took you from conceptualization to this point.
Yeah. Well,
so how could you how could you get the two different timelines?
No, the actual time to the projected time, some are longer than, and they are not necessarily in our control. Right. So, so those are factors that would have led to it. And then, not to be a broken record on it, the starting over element
yes.
would have driven into the space additional time frame.
I hear that. But here's the problem, again, Mr. Powell, because I'm here's what I'm struggling with. Here we have a public entity doing a process that is above board. I hear nobody saying that anything untoward happened. Thank God. You're playing by the rules. To this point, you have yet to collect a single dollar in tax takings in either of those two offices, but you have already paid up $300 million. And you are saying that in real terms, it could not have been avoided by the fact that you had to stick slavishly to the rules. I'm struggling to accept that.
Yeah, that's what we basically
Mr. I wonder, would it have been easier to simply have found a site that was unoccupied and just build a new building, or would you have run into the same hurdles had you gone that route
arrangement? We did that, and because of this incident, that is now becoming our main strategic direction that we're going in. But finding land can be very problematic.
Yes.
In Mandeville, we did an extensive search to find property in Mandeville. We just couldn't find the kind of space that we
The time is going, Mr. Powell. The time is going. I want to ask you, I see in your 7-page response, you have something here to say, that the facility, I think it's the Anotobe facility, that was a bank before.
Yes.
That after signing the lease, getting the keys to the facility, when you went back in there, your officials went back in there to do work, they found that the character of the building was different from what you... How could that happen? What penalty, if any, accrued to the lessee, to the person who held the lease, to change it back to the original form so you could get the work done?
Yeah, well, we had asked the landlord to restore it to what we had agreed on when we had actually started the negotiation, and they did that.
How much more delay did that cause? Did that take 2 months to happen, 3 months, what?
That took, I think, around 4 months.
Before we get, we have to let you go, I have to ask, in this matter where you had to acquire the Anato Bay facility, was it that Mr. I'm not going to name the MP actually, was it that the director's company outbid you for the acquisition?
No, we were trying to put in an letter of interest because we'd have to follow certain procedures, a letter of interest, etc., move. But while we were trying to get to that point, they had apparently been, you know, more advanced in the process than we were, and they ended up being the bad.
So once again, it's just a procurement issue.
On their side, but that's the best I can say that.
We're out of time. You said in your response that based on where you are now, you should be ready to occupy Mandeville by September 2025.
No, not Mandeville.
Mandeville by September 2025.
Yes.
And you will still have to pay the monthly rental lease up to that point.
Yes.
So when are you going to occupy Anato Bay?
We're looking at the... But both second and third quarter, at least third quarter, that we're looking at.
Hear you on that. Thank you this afternoon, Mr. Powell. All the best to you and your team.
Oh, yes. And thanks for having me. Yes.
All right. Let me tell you. Jamaica, we have a problem. We have a procurement process
that the TAG
has followed to the T, they say. And nobody has disputed that. And by the time they occupy Mandeville in September next year, we'll be about $500 million down the hole. I wouldn't call it a dollar in tax revenue yet, and the process works. Ridiculous. Have to change it.
Let's just say that Dr. Clark's presentation on this matter, I think 2 weeks ago, was prescient.
Have to change it. Time for the headlines at 6.
Cover Story was brought to you by
Multilink. Roll with control. Use Multilink. Safe, fast, and accepted in more locations.
Say hello to peace of mind and goodbye to worry with Guardian Life's new Ultimate Provider Plan, and secure your medical expenses in the event of critical illness today. Call 888-367-5433 for details.
The time by Guardian Life is
2 minutes after 6.
Upgrade your kitchen and bathroom to the next level with Unique Living. They are the ultimate destination for all your kitchen and bathroom needs. From luxurious shower systems to exquisite faucets, vanities, sinks, toilets, closets, and more. They have it all. Visit shop number 6, 30 Dunrobin Avenue, Kingston 10, or call them at 876-755-3661. Elevate your space with Unique Living, where quality meets expectations.
Nationwide headlines at 6.
Good evening with the headlines at 6. I'm Mahiri Stewart. According to the Statistical Institute of Jamaica, Statin, for the fourth quarter of 2023, the Jamaican economy grew by 1.7%. That completed 11 consecutive quarters of economic growth since the country emerged from the worst of the COVID-19 pandemic. The goods-producing industries grew by 0.8%, while the services industries grew by 2%. On the goods-producing side, mining was the standout performer, expanding by 21.5%. This was followed by agriculture, which grew by 2.6% for the quarter. However, construction declined by 3.8%. Growth in the services industries was led by tourism, as represented by hotels and restaurants, which improved by 8.3%. An unannounced welfare check was what tipped off the authorities to the abuse suffered by 8 American boys at the Atlantis Leadership Academy in St. Elizabeth. That's according to the Child Protection and Family Services Agency, CPFSA. 7 of the boys are now in the care of the agency. More in this report from Shaloy Smichael.
Atlantis Leadership Academy is located in Treasure Beach, St. Elizabeth. The boarding school advertises itself as a faith-based institution that caters to teenagers struggling with substance abuse, anxiety disorders, and defiant behavior. The institution was catering to 8 American boys aged 14 to 18. On February 8, the CPFSA, along with representatives from the U.S. Embassy in Kingston, made a surprise visit to the institution where they observed signs of abuse and neglect of the boys in question. The boys were subsequently removed from the facility and the matter reported to the police. 7 of the boys are now being kept in residential child care facilities after a court order granted the CPFSA temporary care amid the investigation. CEO of the CPFSA, Laurette Adams Thomas, says the boys are receiving psychotherapeutic support.
The priority of the CPFSA is the well-being of these children while they are in Jamaica. The children have undergone medical assessments and are generally in good health, receiving ongoing care. This includes specialized psychotherapeutic support and occupational therapy.
The other student, an 18-year-old, who was too old for his hearing to be done in the children's court jurisdiction, was safely returned to the U.S. in February in coordination with his family and the U.S. Embassy. Mrs. Adams-Thomas says efforts are being made to return the other boys to their families.
We are also collaborating with the International Social Services, that's ISSUSA, for the safe reintegration of these teens with their families.
Mrs. Adams-Thomas says the matter will return to court in April.
The CPFSA will return to court on the 3rd of April to provide an update on the home studies being conducted and to receive any further instructions from the court.
Efforts to contact Atlantis Leadership Academy remain futile. In the meantime, the CPFSA is reminding the public to report any suspicions of child abuse through its 24-hour hotline 211. They can also send a WhatsApp message to 876-878-2882 or visit any CPFSA parish office. Reports can also be made via social media at CPFSAJM on Instagram, Facebook, and X. Shalois Michael for Nationwide News.
Government Senator Abka Fitz-Henley is blasting as desperate and misleading the claim by PNP President Mark Golding and opposition Senate leader Peter Bunting that Jamaicans have been saddled with a heavy tax burden by the Wholeness administration. Senator Fitz-Henley says the argument is elementary and a sign of the opposition's worsening thirst for power.
The fact of the matter is that the government of Jamaica has managed the economy so well that the economy continues to expand and there is greater efficiency in the revenue collection mechanisms in place. And therefore, the numbers have gone up, continuing to increase. This argument that because the revenue numbers are increasing or have increased significantly over the past few years means that automatically new taxes have been imposed. It's a basic argument. It's an elementary argument I hear being advanced by Messrs. Bunting and Golding.
Senator Fitz-Henley says the fact that the opposition is seeking to attribute an increase in revenues to new taxes amounts to nothing more than desperation politics.
Here are two gentlemen who are so desperate for political power that they are prepared to use convolution and misleading arguments to achieve that objective. That's the kind of leadership that Jamaican people voted out in the past and are not willing to countenance, in my view.
Abka Fitz-Henley, government senator. Attorney at law Isaac Buchanan says there's no animosity between himself and the Director of Public Prosecutions, DPP, Paula Llewellyn. This follows his 2-year suspension from the legal profession by the disciplinary panel of the General Legal Counsel, GLC, last December. The Court of Appeal has granted a stay of the GLC's decision, pending an appeal by Buchanan. Buchanan pled guilty to professional misconduct after directing profane and sexually explicit lyrics from dancehall artist Vybz Kartel towards the DPP. The attorney also made disparaging comments about Justice Minister Delroy Chuck. Speaking during an interview on the popular Let's Be Honest podcast hosted by Jay Frey, Buchanan says he has no beef with the DPP.
prosecutors prosecute. You cannot blame people for doing their jobs. Even whatever decision that she would have made, she said she did it within her wisdom. She said it was a gamble. That's the gamble that she took. It's an executive decision. She's a creature of the Constitution, and she used her office to do what she did within her wisdom. And she has an open door policy. You can call her about other matters that she has assisted me with. So the narrative that there is some animosity and all of that, there is none whatsoever. She does her work. I think generally women with high authority, they get criticism. Just look at the Speaker of the House. She gets a lot of rap for being the Speaker of the House.
Isaac Buchanan, attorney at law. Those are the headlines at 6. I'm Mahiri Stewart. Sports is next.
Get up to $1 million off everything. With the Mitsubishi $1 million seal. Yeah. Price a splash, save cash, run, come catch the Mitsubishi $1 million seal. Get up to $1 million off on your brand new Mitsubishi ASX. Or for Hero Sports with the Mitsubishi $1 million sale. Plus 3 years warranty, 2 years free servicing, and 1 year free Amber Tracker. Follow us on social media at Mitsubishi JA for more info. Hurry up and come get this deal while stocks last. Only at Stewart's Automotive Group, South Camp Road, Kingston, and Iron Shore Bay. Conditions apply.
Yes, me get the last cheese.
Taste the beat.
Brothers and sisters, at the end of Easter service, we have
cheese. Taste the beat.
But one day we're getting a bun and cheese.
Taste the beat. Serve, sell me some bun and cheese. Taste the beat.
Why this look on nice with some tasty cheese.
Taste the beat.
Could I have some cheese, please?
Taste the beat.
Make we get on real bad with the tasty cheese, boys.
Taste the beat with tasty cheese.
You have dreams and goals for the future. You want to make an impact. The UWI Mona, the number one ranked university in the Caribbean, will help you reach your full potential. Our students have gone on to make their mark in all areas, locally and globally. Industry leaders, heads of state, and Rhodes Scholars all got their start with us. Legacies are made at the UWI Mona. Start building yours. Apply by March 31st at mona.uwi.edu/apply.
There's a new gym on the block. Listen up, Portmore. Express Fitness is coming to the Big Buy Plaza. Get ready to sweat at our brand new location. And here's the best part. To celebrate, we're offering an unbeatable deal of only $1,000 for the first month. That's right. For only $1,000, you'll have access to state-of-the-art equipment and a community that's all about reaching your fitness goals. Don't miss out on this exclusive offer. Head down to Express Fitness at Big Buy Plaza in Portmore, where your journey to a better you begins.
Good evening with your sports report. I am Alex Raby. We bowl things off with some cricket. As Jamaica lost by 7 wickets to the Windward Islands at Liberia today in the second round of games in the West Indies Rising Stars Under 15 cricket competition. Tyson Gordon, 51, and Ryan Littleton, 61, top scored for Jamaica in their 193-8. The Windwards replied with 198-3 with 10 overs to spare. Yersin Houphouët-Boigny slammed an impressive 93 to lead the victory chase against Littleton, who grabbed 2-28. At Bethesda, Barbados crushed the Leeward Islands by 94 runs. The Bajans piled up 327-4 on the back of 105 from DJ Wiggins and Jahidi Hines, 81. The Leewards replied with 233 all out. Only LaShawn Bergon, 50, and Josh Edwards, 48, made any useful contribution. At Coolidge, defending champions Trinidad and Tobago lost by 9 wickets to Guyana. Afrif Khan grabbed 5 for 18 as TNT was skidded out for 83 in 24 overs. Guyana easily achieved victory with a 84 from 1 in 18 overs. The competition continues on Saturday with Jamaica facing Guyana at Bethesda. Cricket West Indies CWI is set to unveil its new 4-year strategic plan for 2024-2023, titled Long Run. The recently presented to the board of directors during a board meeting in Antigua and discussed with stakeholders at the annual general meeting, the strategic blueprint marks a pivotal juncture for the organization and West Indies cricket. The long run will outline key objectives and initiatives aimed at fostering growth, sustainability and excellence in cricket. It will encompass measures to enhance governance, player development, grassroots programs, fan engagement and commercial partnerships, aligning with CWI's overarching vision to elevate West Indies cricket in the region and on the global stage. The strategic plan developed internally represents a collaborative effort by the CWI management team. It includes extensive consultations and valuable insights from staff and players. Business planning manager Linford Inveri led the process with input from the wider cricket stakeholders group. Coach of Excelsior High cricket team Kirkland Bailey says they want to sweep the trophies for the 2024 school ball season. The Mountain View Avenue-based school bowled off their quest for lifting the ISSA First Global Bank Grey Seal Trophy. They achieved the feat by beating St. Jago by 420 runs in the final at Sabina Park yesterday. Bailey says a quadruple of titles is achievable.
To be honest, we expect to win at least one or two more, and we are trying to take four, which will encompass the Urban T20, the Spalding Cup and the All-Ireland T20. Nothing is guaranteed, but we are going to give it our best shot.
Kirkland Bailey. The coach of Elite Performance Track Club, Ronaldo Walcott, says it has been a joy training two of the world's best female athletes. Walcott is in charge of conditioning reigning Olympic double sprint champion Elaine Thompson-Hero and her predecessor, Shelley-Ann Fraser-Pryce. Thompson-Hero is open to defend her Olympic 100 and 200 meters titles, while Fraser-Pryce hopes to add another medal to her Olympic collection. Walcott says he doesn't have to do much to motivate the sprinters.
Persons who have achieved a lot, they tend to be very, very focused. So it's way easier to work with mature athletes and younger athletes sometimes, or most times, because they're goal-driven. They understand what it means to be successful, and they understand what to do to become successful. So what I get on a day-to-day basis is an Elaine who is hungry, an Elaine who is willing to do whatever I ask of her. And it's the same thing with Shelley-Ann. And I would have had the experience with Shelley-Ann first, where, okay, I don't have to tell her to do something twice. Matter of fact, she's probably going to be the one who's going to nudge me. Hey, coach, what are we going to do tomorrow? What's the plan for tomorrow? It's just so hungry, despite the success that's there before.
Ronaldo Walcott, manager for Jamaica's team to the carry of the athletics championships, Shireen Richards, says she's confident the country will continue its dominance of the competition. The championships is set for Grenada from March 30 to April 1. Jamaica will be seeking its 38th straight hold on the title, and Richards has no doubt they'll achieve the feat.
The dominance should continue at these championships. Coming off Boys and Girls Athletics Championship, you would have seen who the Caribbean athletes are. And we dare say if one or two are ahead of us, then Jamaica would be second or third in any event. So we're not too worried about that. Jamaica is a Showtime team, and we always give our best when we go to these international tournaments. Boys and Girls Athletics Championship kind of oiled them up for this week, so we're ready to roar.
Richards is no stranger to managing national teams.
First time managing a national team of this magnitude. It's an honor and a privilege, and I'm pretty excited to rear with these students because I know most of them. Well, I've been an assistant team manager before. I've managed the national rugby team to the World Cup and to various tournaments. As I said, track and field is very different. You're looking at a contingent of over 90-odd people, youngsters, who are very impressionable. They're going with coaches. I am one of two females going. The other female is Miss Innes, a coach. So monitoring student athletes at this age is crucial. And my role is primarily to execute the non-technical activities of the team in terms of participation and competition.
Shireen Richards. Now to swimming, as Jamaica's swimmers are in the Bahamas for the Carry of the Swimming Championships from March 29 to April 3. The 37th staging of the championships is set for the Betty Kelly Kenin Aquatic Center. Jamaica's team manager, Annalise Denny, says everything is in place for the country to have a successful showing.
The team are looking good. We have a last team training session and we're very excited. Everything is organized for us in the Bahamas, ready for us. Rooms, you know, transportation, everything is well set. Our gears are on their way. They're looking good, what I've seen so far. So we're very excited about that. We're going to look like a great team. And then for the other update is that we have gotten sponsorship. So we're very happy about that.
Annalise Denny. Finally, in boxing, 38-year-old Nicholas the Axeman Walters continued his comeback from an almost 6 year hiatus by scoring a unanimous 10-round decision victory over the much younger and favored Joseph Ordono at lightweight last night. Fighting in Florida on a pro box card, the former WBA featherweight champion simply outworked his 24-year-old opponent and won on the judges' scorecards of 98-91, 97-92, and 95-94. Walters, who has now boxed just twice since 2016, now has a record of 29 wins and one defeat. 29 of his wins came by way of knockout. I'm Alex Swiby, and that's your sports.
For all your scales and food processing equipment, call Advanced Scales and Equipment Limited at 876-968-9612-5. The time by Advanced Scales and Equipment Limited is
6:20.
Deposit we have insurance. It's an account that comes with assurance. Let me teach you why it's important to have deposit insurance. Just in case your bank crashed dead, no need to put your hands by your head. Up to 1.2 million you get for all accounts that's affected. Yeah, one room you can start it, or throw a house party. Pay your mortgage with ease. JDIC is a smart win. Deposits we bring safety. JDIC them protect me. Bank and billing society protected. The flow you must get with. Protect your savings smart. We urging you to call it. Guarantee you need us. We take banking serious.
JDIC, protecting deposits for you and me.
There's a new gym on the block. Listen up, Portmore. Express Fitness is coming to the Big Buy Plaza. Get ready to sweat at our brand new location. And here's the best part. To celebrate, we're offering an unbeatable deal of only $1,000 for the first month. That's right. For only $1,000, you'll have access to state-of-the-art equipment and a community that's all about reaching your fitness goals. Don't miss out on this exclusive offer. Head down to Express Fitness at Big Buy Plaza in Portmore, where your journey to a better you begins.
You have dreams and goals for the future. You want to make an impact. The UE Mona, the number one ranked university in the Caribbean, will help you reach your full potential. Our students have gone on to make their mark in all areas, locally and globally. Industry leaders, heads of state, and Rhodes Scholars all got their start with us. Legacies are made at the UE Mona. Start building yours. Apply by March 31st at mona.ue.edu/apply.
Public Opinion is brought to you by Cleasing Industrial Supplies Limited, Industrial Automation and Control Solutions.
Good evening. Good evening and welcome to Public Opinion. I'm Mahiri Stewart and we have a banger in store for y'all today, folks. We have an interesting one. Yeah, we're talking food again. And as we prepare to go off on the holidays, this food question is one that is centered around said holidays. And as you see the question, it's pretty obvious who in the newsroom came up with something like this. As a matter of fact, he's just walked into the studio as we speak, yeah? People, today we are asking you, the public, we're settling it, yes? Bun and cheese or bun and fish?
Bun and cheese. Not that I eat it, but it is really the easiest time of the year to give a present. You know, you have to walk up and down Christmas and those other times. No, you just buy a bun and a cheese and you give a present, you know.
You see, the difference is that I eat bun and cheese right through the year. Same thing with the fish too, so it doesn't really matter much to me.
Bun and cheese.
Has to be bun and cheese, man. No other thing but bun and cheese. Bun and cheese. Bun and fish, yeah, but that's like a side thing. But bun and fish can't over the bun and cheese. Bun and cheese is the art of the day.
All right, there you have it, folks. We seem to have a lot of bun and cheese truthers in our voice chat. But, I mean, yes. Listen, I'm not one to voice my opinion when it comes to pop-up. I like to keep it objective. But, like, come on, folks. Bun and fish. That just sounds like somebody was bored and had nothing else to do, man. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? That sounds like somebody was bored experimenting. They didn't have no bread. They're like,
This bun will surely do. I'm a bun and cheese person, you know, folks. And I don't need Easter to eat it. But let's see what y'all say, all right? On Twitter, we got Juvie 2.0 saying, I'ma stick with this. And what did he post? A picture of bun and cheese. Big shocker. However, much to my shock, there is a bun and fish truther in the Twitter chat. Grace Davidson says, bun and fish for sure. Who would have thought? Yes? Let's go over to Instagram. Bun and cheese or bun and fish? Let's see what we have here. Bun and fish for me. All right. You know, it seems as though I'm being proven wrong. Bun and fish for me, says Ford Gidget in our Instagram. But let's take a look at Facebook. Did not expect to see anybody. What do you mean, please reject this request, Diaz Isaacs? Are you a bun and cheese truther? Or are you that of the bun and fish consumers? Which side do you belong to? Yeah, are we going to have another election? It's been a while since we've had an election on Pub Up. You know, this could be a great one. Some AJ Hamilton says bun and patty. So he's just thrown a third one into the mix. I can actually imagine bun and patty tasting quite nice, but it's not one of the two options, yes? Winston says bun and fish can eat together? Yuck. My thoughts exactly, I fear. Ricardo Portia says bun and cheese is what really and truly most Jamaicans rather. Philip Jackson says nothing like the original bun and cheese. Peer, second, and all others follow. Oddly, Philip says bun and cheese are not only Easter. Yeah, Tevin says cheese and bread straight, so he's thrown out the bun and he's gone with bread instead. Michael Henry says, bun and cheese, fish is at 2,000 per pound. All right, fair enough. Mel Boo says both. Natalie Winter says, bun and cheese is an awesome combination. Wesley Cunningham says, no comment. Didn't expect somebody to be on the fence on a question like this, but here we are. Beverly Barrett says, bun and cheese with fish, which that's... All right, you know, everyone has their own opinion. That's the whole point of Pub Up, but that's definitely a choice if I've ever heard one. Fabian Smith says none. Way to rain on our parade, Fabian. What do you eat for Easter if not bun and cheese? What do you do, drink tea and eat bread and butter? That's all right, you know, but like, come on, man. All right, let's take a look at the YouTubers, yeah? What are my YouTubers saying? Which way are they going to lean? Are they going to be on George's side? Are they going to be on the bun and fish side? Or are they going to be normal people and choose bun and cheese? Let's see how many normal people we have in the YouTube comments, yeah? Bali says bun and cheese. There we go. Linda Ming says, I've never had bun and fish. Don't believe I'll try it. Oh, dear. Jacqueline Thomas says bun and fry fish. So there we go. There we have an anomaly. Yes, D.S. Isaac says bun and fish. Wilbert Davis says bun and fish. It works all the time. Okay, I'm clearly out of the loop then. Yes, Jacqueline Thomas says bun and steam fish. St. Best Family says bun and cheese, fish and bammy or festivals. All right, Ava Dice says try it, I tell you. Try the fish. Okay. Doreen Johnson says both. Yeah. Lamour Hines says, bun and fish at bomb. Yeah, Tanya Jones says, bammy and fish. D.S. Isaac says, better them say bun and patty. Marigold Weber says, bun and sprat. Paul Peart says, both. Yeah, what else we got here? Gertrude says, bun and fish. No ready. Fair enough. Oh, thank you for reminding everyone to like this stream. You're absolutely right, Marigold Weber. If you are watching us on YouTube, click the like button. Let's get those likes up. Tanya Jones says bammy. Duchess of St. Andrew says bun and butter. All right, that's a new one. Yeah. Errol Townsend says just bun and bun for me. No cheese. That's certainly a choice, Errol. I don't think there are many like you out there, you know. Bun and bun. Yeah. He has a bun sandwich. So you cut the bun down the middle and just put more bun inside. Or do you just eat the spice bun as is? Okay, now we're having some... Now I'm seeing bun and cheese. CB says bun and cheese. I'm seeing Kimani Bernard. Yolande Ewan Johnson. Joseph R. says bun and fish. Okay. Kirk Buchanan says bun and cheese. Dennis Barnaby agrees. St. Best Family also agrees. Nathan Gale says bun and pork. That's a new one. That's one I didn't expect to hear. Bun and pork. jerk pork, regular pork? What kind of pork are you talking? Not that I care, because I'm not a pork consumer, but it's definitely one that sounds new to me, yeah? Jacqueline Thomas says we should try it. Should we? Maybe we should, you know. You guys might be onto something, you know. Maybe I'm missing out. Maybe I'm the problem, yeah? DS Isaac says, George Davis came up with that question. Let me give George Davis a bag of bulla. So are you suggesting that bulla and fish is also a delicacy? All right, fair enough. What else we got? One Dread says bun and cheese. Anything else is uncivilized. And you see, that's why I'm not the one saying it. Yeah, that's why it's... There we go. Glad somebody else said it. Bev Thompson says bun and sardine. Again, certainly a choice. Not one I'd make, but to each his own. Chaz Ray Star says bun and mayonnaise. I'm genuinely not sure where some of these are coming from. I can't tell if you guys are trolling or if you people actually eat this stuff. Yeah, but... Maybe, you know what I'm saying? Everybody's different. And I tell you what, going through this comment section, it's really shown me that people really do eat bun with a lot of things. And I guess it's not the weirdest thing in the world. Yeah, bun is not that far off from bread. People have tons of different types of sandwiches. So sure, maybe you could have bun with all kinds of stuff too, yeah? Parchment says bun and cream cheese. That sounds interesting. Gillette Sanchez says fish and bread. Marlene P says, red card, you are wrong. To who am I for saying bun and pork? You're absolutely right. Bun and pork is wild, in my humble and honest opinion. But it's not my opinion, is it? It's everyone else's that I'm reading, even though I've already voiced my own. Yeah? Maureen Price says, bun and fish, it is very nice. Bun and pear is quite nice too, says Donovan Combry. Tasty and bun, says IQ, IQ. D.S. Isaac says, some of these food ideas need a red card. You see, I'd be inclined to agree, but I'm going to put on the objective hat again and just let people voice how they feel. You know what I'm saying? That's what pub-op is all about, making people voice how they feel. And if you feel like eating bun and pork, bun and mayo, bun and bun, you do you, man. Bun and anchor butter, that's a new one. Didn't think I was going to see that one, but there we go. Bun and anchor butter, that's a new one. Someone says, buns are too sweet. Gertrude Brown says, the bun them too sweet for me. All right. I can see that. Tanya Jones says, festival and fish. Kareem Constantine says, parrot fish and bun. Not if we're trying to save those reefs, Kareem. Yeah, not if we're trying to save those coral reefs. You know what I'm saying, man? Not if we're trying to save those coral reefs. Kim Hines says, bun and cheese and butter. Adding in a third ingredient. Folks, that's all the time we have for public opinion. A very fun one. This is one of my favorites ever. I didn't think we were going to get this many responses. We got so many different answers, and I had a great time reading all of them. And I'm not going to have a better time reading Business Report, but Business Report's next, so stay tuned. Yeah? Play that music, bro.
Public Opinion was brought to you by Kleasing Industrial Supplies Limited, Industrial Automation and Control Solutions.
Annual eye examinations not only assess your vision, but may be life-saving. Eye tests may detect serious health issues that go beyond your vision. Call IQ Optical to schedule your comprehensive eye test today.
The temperature by IQ Optical is...
It's 28 degrees Celsius in the nation's capital of Kingston and Montego Bay.
Welcome, Milux. The cream cracker that rises to the top.
So crisp, so light, so buttery.
When you're good, you're just good.
Hey,
add the national flavor. You're gonna want to buy this pack.
So good, it's just so good.
Welcome, Milux. The cream cracker that rises to the top.
So crisp, so light, so buttery.
National Baking Company. Just so, so good.
Hello, good evening, and welcome to Nationwide's Business Report. I'm Mahiri Stewart. The Jamaican economy grew by 2.6% for the calendar year 2023 when compared to 2022. That's according to the latest information from the Statistical Institute of Jamaica, Statin. The growth was driven primarily by gains in mining and tourism. According to Statin, for the fourth quarter of 2023, the Jamaican economy grew by 1.7%.
That completed 11 consecutive quarters of economic growth since the country emerged from the worst of the COVID-19 pandemic. The goods-producing industries grew by 0.8%, while the services industries grew by 2%. On the goods-producing side, mining was the standout performer, expanding by 21.5%. This was followed by agriculture, which grew by 2.6% for the quarter. However, construction declined by 3.8%. All other segments of the services industries grew, with the exception of government services. Crypto entrepreneur Sam Bankman-Fried was sentenced Thursday to 25 years in prison for a massive fraud that unraveled with the collapse of FTX, once one of the world's most popular platforms for exchanging digital currency. Bankman-Fried was convicted in November of fraud and conspiracy. U.S. District Judge Louis A. Kaplan imposed the sentence. He said the sentence reflected that there is a risk that this man will be in position to do something very bad in the future, and that it's not a trivial risk at all. Kaplan further ordered Bankman-Fried to forfeit over $11 billion. He also said he would advise the Federal Bureau of Prisons to send him to a medium security prison or less near the San Francisco area because he's unlikely to be a physical threat to other inmates or prison staff, and his autism and social awkwardness would make him very vulnerable to other inmates in a high security location. And finally, the currency markets. At the close of trading today, it cost 154 Jamaican dollars and 70 cents to buy one US dollar. It cost 196 Jamaican dollars and 19 cents to buy one British pound, and 114 Jamaican dollars and 49 cents to buy the Canadian dollar. That's the business report. I'm Mahiri Stewart. Good evening.
We're celebrating 79 years of quality and style at the Ashley Furniture Home Store. We're giving you, our valued customers, 79 discounted styles with up to 50% off dining, lounge, and bedroom pieces. Plus, get 30% off Dartmoor pieces with the purchase of an Atlantic Queen or King bed frame. Get a free oversized chair with the purchase of a Belzali two-piece lounge set. Financing is available. The Ashley Furniture Home Store. This is home. Offers end March 31. Conditions apply.
Did you know that many of my schoolmates have an unhealthy diet, especially at school, and now 23% of them are overweight and or obese? And so one less sugary drink at my school may mean one friend less,
or two or three,
at risk of cavities or diabetes. And if we're served less foods high in saturated fats, sugar, and sodium, it may reduce our risk from obesity, heart disease, and high blood pressure.
The solution is simple, right? Act now.
Let's get unhealthy foods and beverages out of our schools.
A message from the Heart Foundation of Jamaica and partners.
The Jamaica Conch Cluster JCC has received a groundbreaking achievement in receiving the Marine Stewardship Council certification for the Jamaica Queen Conch. This means that the JCC can proudly bear the MSC logo, signaling commitment, sustainability, and profitability. Special thanks to the government of Jamaica and its agencies and their implementation and funding partners, the Compete Caribbean Partnership Facility. For more information, visit the MSC website at www.fisheries.msc.org or contact them directly at conclusterjam@gmail.com.
Drive the most exciting new vehicles in Jamaica. Schedule your 2024 Ford Ranger pickup or Ford Everest 7-seater SUV test drive now. Call or visit KIG today.
I'm Dennis Brooks.
I'm Alan Campbell.
I'm Floyd Green.
And I'm Garth Williams. Catch us on the Jamaican Dads podcast right here on Nationwide 90 FM, Thursdays at 8 p.m. with a repeat on Sundays at 6 p.m.
The Jamaican Dads podcast is all about providing men with a healthy, safe, and functional forum to tackle many of the taboo topics that concern our masculinity.
Like everyone else out there, we're dads of varying amounts of experience who come from different backgrounds and often view the world differently.
We're definitely not perfect, but we are all brethren and we're all committed to this piece of rock called Jamaica.
Too often, there are no safe spaces for men to explore the issues which are important to us.
Plus, most of the content out there about parenthood is produced by women, for women. So we think it is important that we be the change we want to see.
Follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Jamaican Dads with a Z.
And definitely join us here on Nationwide 90 FM every Thursday at 8 p.m. with a repeat on Sundays at 6 p.m. for the Jamaican Dads podcast. It's a revolution in media.
Hi there. Here's some good news for these trying times. Quote, "By God's word, I can see where I'm going. They throw a beam of light on my dark path." Unquote. Psalm 119, verse 105. Listen for God's Word weekdays at 5:45 a.m. and 12:55 p.m. through
Oasis. Stop by for a refreshing drink and share a God perspective for the day.
Oasis. Weekdays, 5:45 a.m. and 12:55 p.m. right here on Nationwide, a revolution in media.
3 broadcast of The Oasis can be heard weekdays at 5:45 a.m.
The Oasis is brought to you by Solar Tech Jamaica. We use the gift of the sun to power our world.
The Olympic Games 2024 live from Paris in France, exclusively on Nationwide 90 FM.
The Jamaican star shines bright once again.
Live here halfway through the Olympic finals.
This summer, Nationwide 90 FM is coming in hot.
Jamaica to the blocks!
Nationwide 90 FM will be blazing as we bring you the games of the 33rd Olympiad live from the French capital, Paris. 16 fantastic days of competition in 41 sports.
Lovely Williams-Mills coming, McCrory flapping, her arms are waving, and lovely Williams-Mills coming through for Jamaica's gold.
The station will bring you analysis and live coverage from the opening day of competition, Friday, July 26th, to the very last day of action on Sunday, August 11th.
And support me! Let's go! Oh, what a run!
Everything and anything Paris Olympic Games 2024 can be heard right here on Nationwide 90 FM.
It is a glittering goal for Sharika Jackson, and how they will celebrate that back in Jamaica.
We'll capture the spirit of athleticism. We'll narrate the Olympic fever, define thrilling moments, and report on the blood, sweat, and tears of the world's greatest athletes. Nationwide 90 FM is going to the Paris Olympic Games, and we're taking you with us. Tune into Nationwide 90.3, 90.5, 90.7, and 90.9 for live updates and commentary. We'll be giving the listeners a front row seat to witness excitement, triumph, and memories.
And I think it was a clean sweep for the Jamaicans.
Stay tuned to Nationwide 90 FM 24/7. Experience the Paris Olympic Games 2024 right here on the Revolution in Media Nationwide 90 FM, your Olympic Center. Exclusively on Nationwide 90 FM.
Looking to rent a fully operational production studio? Then Nationwide 90 FM has got you covered. We have flexible options to meet your recording needs any day of the week. Monday to Fridays, 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. Saturdays and Sundays available upon request. Bookings must be made in advance. Call us today at 630-1210. Let us help you reach your production desires.
History for tomorrow. Yesterday's narrative, today's guide. Join us as we discuss the people, places, and events that have influenced the world as it is today. Remember, knowing your history is essential to understanding the present. So join us on History for Tomorrow, Saturdays at 9 to 11 a.m. with repeats Mondays at 9:30 p.m.
Some of the smartest dummies can't read the language of Egyptian mummies on a flag or a moon. Can't find food for the starving tummies. Pay no mind to the youths, 'cause it's not like...
Music.
6:44 on this Thursday evening, Holy Thursday, March 28, 2024. This is the Nation's Business. My name is George Davis.
And I'm Siobhan Campbell.
Well, we were supposed to make a link with the Minister of Labour and the Social Security, Pernell Charles, but we are not reaching him at this time. While we wait for a producer to try to make that connection, Siobhan, there's a statement that has just come to hand from the Ministry of Transport, and it concerns a fare increase that operators of public passenger vehicles were expecting effective April 1 this year. And I think we should read that for the benefit of the listeners.
Yes, listeners, as it says, this was released today, March 28, not too long ago, a few minutes now. And it says the Minister of Finance and the Public Service, Dr. Nigel Clark, and the Minister of Science, Energy and Telecommunications, Transport, Daryl Vaz, and Permanent Secretaries Carol Palmer and a team from the Ministry of Science and Energy and Transport and the management of the Transport Authority met with members of the Transport Operators Steering Committee and other transport sector leaders to discuss the impending 16% fare increase due April 1, 2024. In asking the sector for a deferral of the expected 16% rate increase, Minister Clark acknowledged that the government recognized the hardships faced by the sector and what a fare increase would mean for the operations, but cited the need to maintain inflation in single digits in order to keep the economy on course, noting that the transportation sector has one of the largest impacts on inflation.
Minister Vaz commended the operators for their understanding and their acceptance of the deferral, and gave his commitment to continue to work collaboratively with them to identify and agree other incentives. In so doing, he mandated the Transport Operator Steering Committee to meet and design a comprehensive transport incentive framework that would take into account measures that would have less adverse impacts on inflation. Minister Vaz also assured the sector that the following concerns would be addressed this fiscal year. 1. Replenishing of rolling stock through an adjustment to the motor vehicle import policy. 2. Implementation of the driver training program. And 3. Upgrading of transport centers across the island.
The statement further says, applauding the minister's collaborative approach since assuming responsibility for the transport portfolio, the representatives from the sector expressed appreciation for the forthright approach taken by Minister Vaz in communicating the government's position in this matter. Wow.
Yeah.
I'm surprised by that development. Not only am I surprised that the government sought that deferral, it was agreed to by the transport operators.
Yeah. I'm not surprised because the numbers as they are not that they are fickle because they're stronger than that, but the situation is still delicate. And I keep asking people, everybody wants all that they believe they are due right now in an economy that's growing at 2.6%. It's impossible. It has never happened in lived history. It has never even happened in fantasy history. Yeah? Not in some phantasmagoric reality has this ever happened, where an economy growing at 2.6% and everybody can get all they want all at the same time at once. Doesn't happen. And so some things will have to give. And this deal brokered between these stakeholders. Good to see the change, though. Usually you'd hear the government make an announcement that, well, you'd hear governments make an announcement that, look, we can't pay it, so we have to defer it. This was a consultative approach, and the stakeholders saying that they are in lockstep, they are in one accord, Honda, and they are agreeing to this deferral.
Yes, credit to Dr. Clark and Mr. Vaz. This could not have been an easy pill to swallow for the operators, considering the circumstances they've been facing. And it's overall good news for the Jamaican people.
Yes.
Inflation has to be kept low as possible, and we don't want to upset the apple cart, so to speak. So it's good to see that we arrived at this decision in collaboration rather than someone being forced at gunpoint to accept a deal.
Yes, so we don't expect any protests come Tuesday morning. All right, let's change course now because we have found the Minister of Labour and Social Security, Pernell Charles Jr., who said recently that his ministry will consider allowing parish councillors and council caretakers to be part of the process to select families for PATH. His position, or the ministry's position, follows a question raised at a forum on Wednesday that was raised by the caretaker for the Independence City Division in St. Catherine, Junior Gale. Mahiri Stewart has that report.
Junior Gale used a forum on Wednesday
to highlight problems he had with the application process for PATH.
Persons in my division has vent their anger and asked me to speak on their behalf. One is the low life of living, life standard that you have to meet in order to be qualified for PATH. Persons that come in the field, they do something different from what you say. I'm telling you, they expect you to be using a chimney, a pit toilet, a single bed with three pitney. They expect you to cook pan wood fire. And these are modern days.
Mr. Gale also recommended to Minister Charles that counselors play a role in the selection of PATH beneficiaries.
I think counselors, not Member of Parliament, counselors and counselor caretakers should be given privileges as to where selection of PATH beneficiaries are concerned, instead of just a computer with an algorithm or whatever you said. Because we as counselor caretaker and counselor, we know the people more than a computer and even more than the MP. So we should be given some privilege to choose or to recommend those persons.
Minister Charles, in response to the first query, highlighted that no person can be rejected from PATH for possessing assets such as basic appliances. He says questions are asked in order to give workers an idea of the situation surrounding each applicant.
Does having a washing machine, a stove, a fridge make an applicant ineligible to receive PATH benefits? If you have those things, does it mean you cannot get on PATH? The answer to that is no. However, if you have a stove, if you have a fridge, if you have all of those things, those are part of what is considered to determine whether or not you are fit for the program or not. We want to make sure that the revision of the program doesn't leave anybody with any confusion. We have to ask these questions in order to find out whether or not somebody is deserving of that support. But we hear you.
Minister Charles says the idea of allowing elected officials in municipal corporations across the island to participate in the selection process for PATH is not a bad one.
The second thing you mentioned about councillors, I'm gonna take your recommendation and it will be put to the group that is dealing with it. I can tell you, however, that many persons may say to you, members of parliament, councillors and others, maybe they're not the best persons to choose PATH applicants. Maybe we should leave it to the social workers so that you don't have a feeling of politics being involved.
Yes, most definitely.
Or maybe you should have both MPs and councillors. So whatever it is that we come up with, the goal is to try to make sure that it's as objective as possible.
Mahiri Stewart for Nationwide News.
Minister Charles joins us this evening. Good evening, Minister.
Evening, gentlemen, and evening to all the listeners.
Excellent. Right, so this thing now, where will it end? I mean, are pastors going to now be given the power to choose who goes on the PATH program? Are the group of JPs also going to be so empowered? Where does this end?
And can I tell you how proud I am listening to the clip of being a Jamaican in a country where people can express themselves freely and actually be heard and listened to.
Yes.
And that's what this overhaul is about, for everybody to come and say, listen, this is what I feel should happen. I don't mean I agree with you. I may not agree with everything you say, but the fact is, all of those opinions are now going to be put to our technical working group to determine what is the best way forward. So should JPs be a part of that process? I can't tell you yet what the outcome will be, but I can tell you we're looking on all of the various persons, from public health nurses to guidance counselors to MPs, counselors, JPs, to see what is the complement of persons who should have the responsibility or the authority to assist us in defining who really should be on this program. And maybe we do need to open it up. Maybe we do need to look on having a wider range of persons contributing to the process. But that's exactly what this revision is about. Gathering all of the questions, putting it to the team, and then over the next couple of weeks and months, going through some very rigorous workshops and analysis to determine what the outcome is going to be.
All right. Here's the thing. Based on what Mr. Gale said at the forum, he reflects what I've often heard, but I've not heard it to be true. I've not heard it confirmed. You are best placed to do so. A lot of Jamaicans have it in their heads that only those in the most dire situations end up on path. For instance, if you have a fridge and you have a stove, clearly your circumstances from the evidentiary, from the empirical, are different from somebody who uses a pit latrine, who cooks on a wood fire if rainfall, you can't light stove, who has to go to the standpipe to draw water. But how much do those circumstances account for the ultimate selection of somebody?
They are very important in who you ultimately select, and they ought to be. You know, when we were in Portmore yesterday, I listened to a very intelligent lady asking questions, giving comments, expressing herself, complaining almost about some of the issues, and she almost sounded to me like, you know, why ask these questions about pit latrine? Nobody doesn't have that anymore, so don't ask that. And I didn't respond to her then. But the reality is that we're a developing country, and you do find circumstances where people are in situations that you would never believe. So you have to ask these questions so that you can get the facts. And when you get the facts, you use those facts to determine who is fit and who is not fit.
So you'd say now, that. So Minister, sorry. So pit latrine, wood fire to cook meals, one room in a house of only one room, not one bedroom, but one room. No, those give more points toward path than other circumstances?
Well, I wouldn't say more than other circumstances, but what you asked me is whether those things are considered, and I'm saying yes.
Yes.
Those will be heavily weighted, because the likelihood of you being in a certain category in terms of your economic standing based on having a pit latrine and a wood fire, those are representations that you need help more than me, who has a stove and a flush toilet.
Right.
Now, the question that Jamaicans want to know is whether the fact that you have a stove or a flush toilet should block you from getting the support. And the answer to that is no. The majority of persons who are on path now have stove and have flush toilet.
Mm-hmm.
But the question itself is still relevant. Because even though it is a minority, a very small minority, you still have persons in those circumstances. And it is still relevant to us in terms of gathering information. But what is ultimately significant for us going forward is to make sure that there is clarity so that all persons who come to our office and say to us, I want to be evaluated to see if I can join this program. I want it to be simple, clear, so that when you leave, if you have been approved or if you've been rejected, you understand why. Right now, there's too much confusion, too much speculation and assumptions as to why or why not. These are the things that we are looking on now, so that when we redesign PATH, whatever it comes out to be, will be something that you can look and say, all right, these are my characteristics. I'm a person with disability. I am this age. I'm under these circumstances. That's why I got on. That's why I did not get on. We want to remove the confusion. So that's what all of these questions that we're getting, we put them to the committee, and we're working out now to develop a system where we'll have less questions and more clarity.
But Minister, in that case, when we're talking about exclusionary criteria, what role would a counsellor or a counsellor caretaker play in establishing that? Wouldn't that just come down to the officer and the Ministry of Labour just sitting down with the potential beneficiary and going through that checklist? I don't understand how adding a counsellor, a caretaker, a JP or anybody else would be more beneficial to that process other than if the process is already in train.
So, very good question, and let me clarify. I am not suggesting that we should add a counselor, a JP, or anybody to that process. That's a question that was posed by Mr. Gale, and I think it is a relevant question that we can consider. As it is now, Our social workers and our experts at the Ministry of Labour, they go through the BIS system first, which is the first engagement, where they ask you a number of questions. They ask you about your dwelling. They ask you about the composition of your family, how many kids you have. Are you working? What do you have in your home? What do you have around you as your assets? They ask you all of these questions to determine your standing, to see whether you're somebody who really needs help or needs help, but not as much as the persons who are on PAS, whatever it is. Now, the verification and those processes now are done by us at the Ministry of Labour and our experts who are trained and who have the qualification to do that, our social workers. As to whether we will open up for other categories of persons to join in the identification of persons of PAS, that would be, let me give you an example. It would be, for instance, if you have a student who is at school, not on PAS, but a guidance counselor interacts with that student and gets information from them about their circumstances and says to themselves, I think this person will be fit for PAS. The question that we're asking is, should that guidance counselor have a formal way to participate by being able to submit that person for consideration? And I think it's a, I think it's something that we can consider, not something we've seen yesterday, but it's something we can consider in the revision of PAS. And how can other persons, such as Justice of the Peace, help us in making sure that ultimately we achieve our goal, which is we want a Jamaica that is equitable. And we want a Jamaica where the right people are on the right programs. And why I reiterate that is because many, many persons now listening and many persons who have a complaint that they were rejected by the system and rejected by the appeal process, maybe PAS is not the program for you. Mm. But it doesn't mean that there's not another program in the Ministry of Labour and Social Security that will be quite suitable for you. Right? So that's something which we're trying to get across. The fact that you did not get on or do not get on to PAS does not mean that we're saying you don't need help. It may just mean that we want you to go to another program. And so a big part of what I'm looking on now in the contemplation of what the new structure to provide social security services will be for Jamaica is how do we make all of those programs connected and fair so somebody who needs help but cannot find that help in PAS can find that help in our rehabilitation public assistance program or find that help somewhere else in the ministry. And if it's not in the ministry, they can find that help somewhere else in the government.
And Minister, does the MP play a formal role in that process? I know there are many instances where someone has gone to the PAS office and been told that they cannot get the benefit. They appeal through the Member of Parliament and then receive the benefit. Is the MP somehow weighted, in terms of the MP's recommendation, weighted in that decision-making process? Is that a formal thing?
My response to that would be that every member of parliament, every elected official, including councillors, has the opportunity to write a letter of support, of recommendation, on behalf of somebody who might be a potential PAS beneficiary. I've done it as an MP, even before becoming Minister of Labour. Persons have come to me and said, listen, I'd like to be on PAS. Can you help me? And I've written to the parish office, and they've gotten support. Some of them have not gotten support. So I think that the MP's letter, like any other person, like a JP or so, does carry some weight because in that capacity, in your position, we would expect that you would be able, through your connections, to identify and to suggest persons to us who really need the help. But it doesn't mean that we're not going to go through the process of assessment or verification.
Yes.
We will.
So.
And sometimes that process may lead us to disagree with the submission. And most times, I think it will lead us to agree with the submission.
So basically, let me hear what you're saying then. Given this exercise that your ministry has undertaken and the consultations you are doing, at the end of the process, we, the public, should expect a streamlined instrument for assessment from the perspective of the workers who actually go to these homes and make that assessment. And that instrument will be reviewed by a council of I don't want to call them experts, a council of reviewers then, that you'll determine who should people that council and how many people should be on that council, whether it's a 5 or 7 or an odd number for obvious reasons if they have to vote. Is that what we should expect at the end of it?
Let me help you. We have two working groups. Technical working group one, which is dealing with the design of paths, which means the selection criteria, which is primarily what we're speaking about now, and other things that are within the structure of paths. And the second working group is dealing with the rules, meaning right now, if you are a student and you're receiving benefit from PATH, you're mandated to make sure that you attend school and consistently attend school. If you're a pregnant, lactating mother, you're mandated to go to the health clinic if you're getting support from PATH. So those are rules. So those two working groups are looking to see whether we keep or remove or adjust or add to the design and the rules. Those two working groups will now push their recommendations to a steering committee. And that steering committee is going to be a committee that will ultimately help us to design the new look program. To see that program now, which as you said, will be streamlined and will be clear and will be effective and responsive. And also, one of the things that I've been vehement in saying is we are imperfect. So the program must, from the start, contemplate review, which currently our program does. Every 2 years, PATH program is reviewed. Every 4 years, PATH beneficiaries are assessed to see, or should be assessed to see whether they should stay on the program. So the monitoring and evaluation is going to be critical so that the outcome of our review will be sustainable and will be consistently improving as we go through. What we've found in the last 22 years is that the PATH program has been a success, but because the environment has changed and the PATH technology has maintained itself as being static, it is no longer as effective as we want it to be in achieving the goals of proper selection and proper maintenance of persons on the program.
And obvious question, is this a bipartisan approach? In other words, if the administration changes next year, will we have a new way of doing this design of the instrument and establishment of what PATH is to be able to do for the beneficiaries?
What I would say to you is that for the development of the country, we would want to make sure that these important projects are carried through. So anybody listening knows what they can do to ensure that this program continues and the review continues. I'd say that, you know, I can't speak for any other person who would come in or any other party, but I'd speak for this government that it's a policy of ours, a priority of ours, is to create an equitable society. So we would be definitely carrying through on this project.
Yeah, but it could change. But all right, but that's outside of your powers. The other thing is this.
What we have to do is make sure it don't change.
Well, that's what the public will have to do. The Prime Minister mentioned something the other day, Minister, in his budget presentation, and we were asking this question among ourselves here in the newsroom in the production department at Nationwide. The children born after
independence.
Yeah, the 60th anniversary of independence. So that would be
2022.
Good.
August 6th, 2022.
Who would benefit from the initiative that he announced?
Yes.
Will they, from the fact that they get automatic subscription by being born at the start point, does that sustain them all the way through to 18, or will their circumstances be examined to see if they no longer need inclusion in that facility? Help me with that.
So we're still tying up some of the intricate details of that, but the goal is to make sure that anyone who has been on PATH after August 6, 2022, and at the age of 18, requires support, will have access to that support. The goal is to make sure that we can ensure that our Jamaicans who were not born into circumstances that were favorable will receive the support from the government to ensure
that they have an opportunity to be anything they want to be, to maximize their full potential. It is our hope that some of the persons who are on the program will not need that support. But for now, based on the Prime Minister's mandate, the intention is to make sure that that support is available to all persons born after that particular date who have been students on the PATH program.
Hear you on that. So okay. The other thing is this. I always wanted to ask this. Well, not always, but the Survey of Living Conditions is delayed, so I can't get that answer. What percentage of households across the country still have a pit latrine, Minister?
I couldn't tell you. It's very few.
Single digits? The percentage?
Probably even less than that. But very few, because a lot of work has been done through the social housing program, providing all members of parliament in a bipartisan way with an opportunity to identify those kinds of families and to give them that opportunity free through the government support to be improved and to come out of that standing. So it's been whittled down to minute numbers now, particularly because of the social programs and the structured programs that are coming out. I want to make it clear. The stronger our economy becomes, the more stable we are, is the more money we have available for Jamaica to develop itself. And so, sometimes we ask what these macroeconomic big numbers mean to the poor people. Well, this is what it means. When we have a strong economy, when we have strong ratings, when we have large investment, when we have stable dollar, we have more money to provide more support for PAS. That's why 28.8% increase in allocation for PAS in this financial year coming. More than 150% increase in allocation for social pension for this year coming. And I could go on and on. Minimum wage increase for this year coming. And all of these things are because of sound, sensible decisions and good management. That's what the macroeconomic means to the poor people on the ground. My ministry is a people's ministry.
I hear you on that.
We take care of the poor and vulnerable, and that's why we have the PAS review. That's why we're pushing the social pension. That's why we rely on you here at Nationwide to get the word out there. We need you.
All right. So the minister says the social security is becoming even more secure. Thank you very much for your time, Minister. All the best.
One love.
Okay. That's the Minister of Labour and Social Security, Pearl Charles Jr. After the break, the information, well, not the information minister, he was the information minister eons ago. The transport minister. We tried to get it, but we didn't get through. All right, let's take the break and come right back.
Accelerate your career with the right ally. Mona School of Business and Management. Explore our suite of highly ranked, specialized, globally competitive graduate degrees, including our internationally accredited MBA program. At MSBM, we nurture critical thinkers and innovative leaders, placing our graduates in a league of their own. Join the community of trailblazers making an impact at home and abroad. Apply online today. Global knowledge, regional solutions.
Home is where you put down your roots. So at Sagicor Bank, we designed a mortgage with everything you need to own your home easier. Get up to 100% financing, fast processing time, up to $100,000 cash back to assist with expenses, a competitive interest rate, plus an unsecured loan of up to $2 million to go solar at home, and a special rate on home insurance. Let's help you put down your roots. Call 888-SAGICOR to apply for your Sagicor Bank mortgage. Conditions apply.
There's a new gym on the block. Listen up, Portmore. Express Fitness is coming to the Big Buy Plaza. Get ready to sweat at our brand new location. And here's the best part. To celebrate, we're offering an unbeatable deal of only $1,000 for the first month. That's right. For only $1,000, you'll have access to state-of-the-art equipment and a community that's all about reaching your fitness goals. Don't miss out on this exclusive offer. Head down to Express Fitness at Big Buy Plaza in Portmore, where your journey to a better you begins.
Yes, me get the last cheese.
Says the beat.
Brothers and sisters, at the end of Easter service, we have cheese.
Taste the beef.
But one day we're getting a bun and cheese.
Taste the beef.
Serve, sell me some bun and cheese.
Taste the beef.
Why, this looking nice with some tasty cheese.
Taste the beef.
Could I have some cheese, please?
Taste the beef.
Make we get on real bad with the tasty cheese, boy.
Tasty beats with tasty cheese.
Welcome, me lots. The cream cracker that rises to the top.
So crisp, so light, so buttery.
When you're good, you're just good.
Hey!
Had the national flavor. You're gonna want to buy this bag.
So good. It's just so good.
Welcome, me lots. The cream cracker that rises to the top.
So crisp, so light, so buttery.
National Baking Company. Just so, so good.
I'm trying to explain to Chevron Campbell off air the reason behind bun and fish, because he's never had bun and fish and the man despised bun and fish. But I understand.
The combination is clashing. When you had
a piece of fried fish with a slice of bun or two slices, it is delectable. And the reason bun and cheese works, the reason bun and cheese works is because of the contrast in taste and texture. So that's why that works as a brilliant combination. The reason ackee and saltfish works is because of the difference in taste and texture. Ackee and saltfish, ackee and red herring. So bun and fried fish is just the height of contrast, Mr. Campbell. And one day, next week, I'm going to bring a shear for you. But for now, let's go to the Transport Minister, Darrell Wesley-Vaz, who's talking to us about a statement sent by his ministry and the finance ministry, collaborating, of course, after that meeting with transport stakeholders. And the agreement is that the 16% fare increase due to these transport operators, which would have taken effect on the first day of the new fiscal year, April 1, has been deferred. No date for the deferral set, just deferred until the fiscal accounts get even stronger. Minister Vaz, good evening.
Good evening, Sir George, and Sir Chevron, and your listeners, and happy Easter to you all.
Thank you very much. So you put the transport operators in a room and you threatened them to agree to this thing?
The complete opposite.
Tell us.
So, you would recall that I did announce an increase, a phased increase, in November last year of 19% and 16% effective April 1st. And you'll also recall that the Minister of Finance also made some adjustments to the JUTC fare structure to try and cushion the effect of the inflation, the increase on inflation. Well, the truth is that I was in a discussion with the Minister of Finance earlier this week, when he told me that the situation in relation to the inflation rate was very, very sensitive, and that if the increase took effect, it basically would be giving in one hand and taking in the other hand, but not taking only from the transport operators, but from the Jamaican citizens, especially the vulnerable. So in my usual style, I invited the minister to come to a meeting at the transport ministry this morning to meet with the steering committee, which I had formed shortly after I became minister last year in May, and of course the wider transport associations. Minister Clark gave a very thorough presentation in his usual style in relation to what we are trying to achieve and what impact this would have, and I'm happy to say that at the end of the presentation, there was a consensus by all of them, not one dissenting voice, that in the interest of the wider population, they would agree to defer it. And as you said, no date was given. And no date was given because of the fact that it is a wait-and-see game in relation to the inflation figures. And I want to just publicly state that my commendations and appreciation to them all for the responsible approach that we agreed to take this morning. I was in a hot seat because my credibility was at stake And I made that clear because I was the one who made the announcement and negotiated with them the 19 and the 16 to cushion the inflation. And obviously for me to go back and indicate to them that I'm asking them to defer it was a tall order. And thankfully, I had enough, brownie points.
Yes, goodwill, chips in the bucket, yes.
Goodwill based on my relationship that I've built with them and the fact of what we have been able to achieve outside of this in terms of some of the pressing issues in the transport sector.
Did you invite the opposition spokesman on transport to this meeting?
100%. As a matter of fact, he is still a member of the steering committee despite our little tiff that we had last year.
Was he present?
In Parliament on Tuesday,
yes.
He acknowledged receipt of the invitation and told me that he was traveling the following day, which was Wednesday,
yes.
On personal business,
yes.
And apologized to me. I did discuss with him at Parliament exactly what the intention was and basically got his support in terms of understanding what I was trying to achieve.
Here's the question, no minister. So you say that I don't know if they're only men, but to a person on that steering committee, they understood the presentation, the position the government is in, the presentation by Minister Clark, the intervention by yourself, and there was no dissension to the deferral. What I find remarkable is that they left that meeting without getting a sense, an idea of when the 16% will be triggered, or the next fiscal year later on. They just accepted that just like that?
So the question was obviously asked of the minister, who could not give an indication, but said that definitively he thought that the lag effect of the inflation situation as it stands now would take us more to the end of this year, into the first quarter of next year. So he didn't confirm that we would be able to implement it, but he was given a timeline in which he expected that we would be able to get the inflation figures down and under somewhat more control. But in fairness, he did not make any promises. He didn't make any commitments. And again, that's why I'm saying what I said earlier, which is just the commendation of the responsible approach and the understanding. Because there's no two ways about it. They are hurting. They were due at 20% back in 2021, so they really are still 1% behind from 2021. There are other things. And I agree to meet next week with the steering committee because there's other things outside of a fare increase that I think can cushion the effects of the deferral in terms of expanded routes. Some of the routes at JUTC are not have ring fence and are not servicing properly. The refleeting of the aged vehicles that they have. The driver's training program that still has not been implemented. So I agree to meet with them next week to basically, as I said to them today, out of adversity comes opportunity. The one thing that I would say to you is that the minister has agreed to further discussions with them in terms of the holistic approach to the transport sector with a view of making funds available in the next financial year, which would be when I say making funds available, substantial changes and funds. But there's not to say that there's things that we can't do, low-hanging fruit, that we can't do in this financial year. And he has committed to look at any proposal that we bring forward that has a fiscal requirement and implication. So I just want to say again, let me tell you, it was that easy. This is probably one of the hardest things.
Here's the thing, Minister. Here's the thing. Here's where I'm thinking. I'm thinking that by the end of the year, how many new buses are you projecting to bring into the island?
114 114 that are confirmed.
Yes.
And hoping to order at least another 30 and at a low, and possibly 130 at a high.
All right.
But those buses won't arrive until the next calendar year.
Right. But between now, between today in March and the end of the year, how many do you expect to arrive here and start running?
Confirmed 114.
All right, good. So 114 buses are coming. Because here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking maybe compliance now could turn to grumbles later on, because you are going to put 114 more JUTC buses, at the very least, on the road between now and the end of the year.
Uh-huh.
You've deferred this portion of the increase until perhaps the first quarter next year.
Uh-huh.
So you're going to have more competition for the players in the transport sector now who are depending on an increase that they will now not be getting. Perhaps it is that you're probably going to have trouble on the horizon when the squeeze gets on, when those additional JUTC buses start running.
So let me answer that very clearly for you. We are rolling out 200 to 220 buses per day with a requirement of 500 buses at a minimum, 700 at a optimum. I made mention a while ago of expanding or contracting some of the routes that JUTC has now that they are unable to service properly because of the amount of buses that they are rolling out. So that in itself is an opportunity to tighten up JUTC in terms of the service that they give and the reliability of the timing of the service that they give, and allow for the transport operators to take up some of that slack. So what I'm saying is, in essence, does it make sense that we don't have the rollout that we need for JUTC and hold on to some of these prime routes? It is better that we contract those routes for JUTC, make them service them better and more reliable and timely with newer buses. Average age of the buses are 14 years now, 14 years old, which is a disaster. But that is in itself an opportunity for these transport operators to be able to have expanded routes and additional revenue. So that is something that I'm going to look very clearly at in conjunction with JUTC and the steering committee, because I believe that that is a way to cushion some of the impact, and secondly, to allow them to refleet, increasing the age limit for vehicles for the public transportation system, which were more reliable and, of course, fuel efficient. So I have some work to do, but my commitment to them is that despite the fact that they may be not earning additional fares and revenues from a fare increase, that we can work to see how we can get them to be able to be more cost-effective in their operations, and of course widen and give them some additional routes that are currently held by JUTC but not being serviced properly. So it's a win-win for the public transportation operators, the PPV operators, and also for the traveling public. A lot of work to do, George, Helsevan, but my commitment is there, because what they agreed today and agreed, I wouldn't say seamless, but in a very responsible and understanding way, is a benefit to obviously those who are feeling the effects of the inflation. And I just want to say again that the way it was approached is not the big stick. That's not my approach. Put them in a room, just as I did as I became minister. Reason with them. And I think I came out, although I thought that I would come out losing some credibility, I was reassured by them that my approach was very appreciated, and that I had actually gone up
in their estimation.
In their estimation.
Minister.
Minister,
in speaking of commitments, at the start of January, we're now, I believe, 3 months in, going into the fourth month, you had suggested 6 months to see a very decent improvement in the transport system. Are we still on track?
Uh, I am expecting to have 14 new buses arrive here in the month of April and 100 new buses arrive here in the month of June, latest first week of July, in order to be able to roll out for the new school year. So that in itself is a major, major accomplishment in terms of service delivery by JUTC. And one of the things that was discussed again today, and I will just throw it out there, is the situation with the transport centers across the country. We have 54 transport centers. They are mostly managed, owned and managed by the Ministry of Local Government, but regulated by Transport Authority. And that was a discussion with the minister today, because they are not in habitable condition. There is no shelter, there is no seating, there is no bathroom facilities, there is no proper lighting, and there is no proper surface, road surface within the transport centers. So that's also something I'm going to be tackling with the Minister of Local Government and the Minister of Finance to see if we can find some money through the Ministry of Finance.
Yeah.
But as I said, my commitment is to do whatever I can do and make whatever interventions I can make to improve the service delivery and the situation that the transport operators face on a daily basis.
We're out of time, but in 20 seconds, any progress being made in your investigation about the coordinated attack on buses out in Eastern St. Andrew?
Nothing concrete. We get some information from time to time, but still no proper breakthrough in terms of breaking the ring in terms of these attacks on the buses.
But based on the preliminary investigation, is it one person or group of persons? What?
It seems to be a group. It seems to be a group.
Oh boy! All right. Thank you for it.
Again, thanks very much, and I cannot close without saying again to all of the transport operators across the length and breadth of Jamaica, those who are there and those who are not there, my appreciation for the responsible decision that we came to today. And as I said, it's a high point for me in terms of being able to manage a situation like this to the best in the best interest of the traveling public.
Thank you very much, Minister. All the best.
God bless you.
All right, good. We take a break. Back with more after these.
Go crazy for this offer from Flo. Get a free Samsung phone and earbuds when you sign up for Flo Yard and Road for the special price of $4,999 plus GCT. Free is all the craze. This crazy offer won't last long. Visit discoverflo.co or your nearest Flo store for more info. Conditions apply.
The Integrity Commission statutory declaration form has changed. Download the new form and file securely within your organization before March 31. The time by the Integrity Commission is
7:32.
Home is where you put down your roots. So at Sagicor Bank, we designed a mortgage with everything you need to own your home easier. Get up to 100% financing, fast processing time, up to $100,000 cash back to assist with expenses, a competitive interest rate, plus an unsecured loan of up to $2 million to go solar at home, and a special rate on home insurance. Let's help you put down your roots. Call 888-SAGICOR to apply for your Sagicor Bank mortgage. Conditions apply.
Welcome back to Nationwide at 5. There's an interview that we're going to play for you between Stephen Sacker, the Hard Talk host, and the Prime Minister, or the President, rather, of the People's Republic of Guyana, Dr. Irfan Ali. It is golden. Before we get to that, though, let's deal with the important matter of the Made in Manchester Expo, because initially launched 9 years ago, the Expo aimed to enhance the visibility, brand recognition, and growth opportunities from micro and small business owners in Manchester, it remains today the cornerstone of community marketing, the championing of local enterprises, and the fostering of a more sustainable economy. The Made in Manchester Expo is calling for increased corporate support to further celebrate, showcase, and elevate the visibility of micro, small, and medium-sized enterprises in the region. This year's event is set for Sunday, March 31, from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. 8 hours of goodness in Mandeville. The CEO and principal consultant of 2020 Strategies Consulting, they're behind it, Annette Salmon, join us. Well, she joins us this evening. Good evening, Annette.
Good evening. How are you this evening?
Thank I'm fine.
So
how are you?
Thank you for having me.
How are you?
I'm great. Thank you so much for having me.
You're welcome. Today is Thursday, so tomorrow is no work because tomorrow is Good Friday. They have Good Saturday, and then they have very good Sunday for the Made in Manchester Expo. Talk to me about the event.
Let me tell you, tomorrow is no work for you. For all the women who are here on the ground trying to get ready for Sunday, I'm sure they have so much ends to put together to be ready to embrace all of our visitors that are coming to support us on Sunday.
And on the point of visitors, Annette, so imagine that I'm coming there. I've never been there. I've only heard that this women's expo is taking place in Manchester. What am I likely to see when I get there? What am I likely to experience?
Okay, so once you step on the ground, the first thing that is going to come at you is the Startup Village. And the Startup Village is where we like to showcase and celebrate our first-time business owners. So these persons have started their business between 6 months to a year. And you know, well, you may not know, but when you're a startup, there's so many challenges that you have to, you know, go through to, in order to just survive, you know, testing the market, getting feedback from people, gaining your confidence, growing your ability to sell, all of those things. So we spend time and energy just making sure our startups are felt and encouraged and motivated. And I want to say a big thank you to National Banking and for Nutfield Express for sponsoring those forces in the village. So because of them, these 8, well, it should be 10. Hopefully we'll get to 10 on a Sunday, but 8 confirmed and ready to showcase their business. Because of these 8 persons, they have been given all of the promotional material they need for the day to showcase themselves. So the banners for the tent, the cards for their tables, the spots in the actual venue have been covered by Nutford Express and by National. Now, when it comes to what kind of business are in this particular zone, you're going to see women have started making their own jewelry, handmade jewelry. They're making beauty products. They're into farm and garden. Some of them are doing business services. So, you know, if you're a business operating from home or you have a physical setup and you need persons to help you in terms of a virtual assistance, we have virtual assistants who are going to be there to, you know, talk about what they do and to encourage more persons to get to know them and their service. So it's a mixture. Plus, we have fashion. There are persons who are into their bakers. They have their home bakery. So it's such a mixture. That's one of the things I love about this event. You get the entire range of women in business. And we're not only talking about micro business and people who are at home, but we're also talking about persons who are in the service business. They're educators. They have written their books. We have one woman in particular. She has written 4 children's books in a year. They're now available on Amazon. And the Made in Manchester Expo is literally going to be her launch pad.
Mm-hmm. So what's in it for the children?
For the children, we have like gardening sessions. So you come and you learn how to, you know, transplant your flowers, what soil to use, how to make them grow. We also have cooking demonstration, how you cook your vegetables. So we don't have the regular things like other events like the bounce about.
Yes,
and other things,
yes.
But it's a very interactive day. And don't get it wrong, you know, because we have a little fireball there. She was at our exhibitors briefing on a Tuesday. Mm-hmm. And let me tell you, she had a point to make about encouraging adults. She's 9 years old, and she's very much into business, having her product line in terms of her beauty products and her jewelry. And she says, listen, when I started, I made like $13,000 one time because I went to this event. But then on my second event, I only made $500. So every day will not be the same. Let me tell you, these kids, they don't only want to jump up on a bounce about it here.
Yes.
There are some children who are ready to take on the world of business. They're ready to be mentored, and they want to use whatever gifts and talents they have right now. They want to monetize those. And they're very, very happy and confident in themselves. And we've had children over the years come and participate in. The ones who don't participate, they go back and look at what they need to do. And their parents encourage them. And then next year, they come and they're involved in the expo as well.
So
it's that kind of vibe that you're going to be getting. A lot of learning, practical things.
Overall, how many women and their businesses do you expect to be on display at the event on Sunday?
About 50. You know, we're on the 40-something mark, so, and we have a few late persons who are registering, so about 50, you know, plus businesses that will be on show on the day.
And I know I said Mandeville, but exactly where?
It's at Scotiabank. Scotiabank is the only operable Scotiabank in Mandeville right now, at the corner of Ward Avenue and Caledonia Road. And outside of the businesses, we're also going to be having health checks by the Manchester Health Department. They have been our partner for a while. Because, you know, it's okay to be in business. It's okay to want to grow and all of that. But at the same time, if you're not healthy, there is no business. So we always want to pair growing your business, thinking about business, expanding along with the healthy side. You get to do your BMI checks. You get to do your blood pressure, your blood sugar. And the BMI, which is the body mass index test, it will tell you whether or not you're in the safe range. It will tell you, you know, what you need to do to change your diet, what foods you should eat, what food you should not eat. So there's a nutritionist who is on board as well. So we really have worked on making it into a very holistic day.
Excellent. Well, Annette, I wish you all the success. I hope the rain stays away. You have excellent weather. And that from the crack of 10 until 6, that it will be a very wholesome day for the exhibitors and the crowds that will be coming down to share in the experience.
Thank you so much. And may I just add this would not have been possible. Scotiabank has been our partner now at this particular venue for the past 3 years. They're very supportive for women in business. Even prior to the pandemic, Scotia has been our partner in different ways for this particular business community. So I want to give a big shout out to them. I also want to say thank you to 876 Get, who is our partner in getting the word out. National, as I said before, National Baking, for helping these startups to really, you know, go through that gate and go over that hurdle and get exposed some more. Lusford Express, I want to thank K.N. Hill Communications for helping us get all the media buzz that we have been getting. NCU, Mandeville Week, and of course, I cannot forget the Parish Council, the Manchester Municipal Corporation. They have been helping us since the beginning. Because, you know, when you do these events, you have to ask for permits.
Yes.
And you have to pay for it to put up signs and everything. And they have been giving us waivers now for a few years. And last but not least, I would like to say a big thank you to Alcapow. Alcapow is literally powering the event by providing us with everything we need for our electric, for, you know, that physical electricity to be at the venue on the day. So it takes a lot. It takes a whole village. And I just want to say I'm so grateful and so thankful to this particular community of business owners, these women who support each other, because you know how it is. We believe that women are the backbone of our country, and more importantly, we believe that every single community, if the women rise, if the women are taken care of, if the women grow, if they have sustainable businesses, their families will be better, their households will be better, and all that is going to do is provide a rippling effect for the growth and the economic development of our country. So it makes a lot of sense. So we just want to invite Manchester to come out and support us, or families in St. Elizabeth. Our neighbors normally support us, Clarendon and Kingston. Please come out. It's going to be a wonderful day. And just come and just infuse your energy by encouraging the sect of businesswomen.
CEO and Principal Consultant of 2020 Strategies Consulting, Annette Salmon. Thank you very much. All the best.
Thank you so much for having me. Bye.
Bye-bye. All right. Let's go straight into it, because hard talk. Stephen Sacker, the host and the president of Guyana, Dr. Irfan Ali.
Mr. President, you lead a country which by many measures has the fastest growing economy in the world. It is down to you to ensure that this massive windfall your country has is used wisely and fairly. Do you feel the pressure?
I don't think it's a pressure. It definitely is a challenge, but it is an opportunity. And to understand this growth and what it means for our country, I think you have to have an appreciation also from where we came and the type of difficulties we have overcome as a country to be where we are today. And that gives you an understanding as to the starting point. And the starting point for Guyana has never been oil and gas. We're a country that came through a very painful past, 28 years of dictatorship. We had democracy reinstalled in 1992. And then from then, we were the second poorest country in the hemisphere. Our debt to GDP ratio was insanely high. We were using 98 cents on every dollar to repay foreign debt. Without oil and gas, we managed to bring that down to 5 cents on every dollar in the repayment of foreign debt. And then, of course, we had challenges in the last elections when the last government, after losing the elections and losing a no-confidence motion, took some time. It took some time to get them to accept the results and to have democracy maintain its position.
Yeah, and that actually for a while looked like it was going to be deeply problematic. There is a fragility to politics here, which we will discuss in a moment. But just to stick with this idea of the unbelievable transformation in your economy. In terms of your GDP, it's rising exponentially. 60% the year before last, 30% last year. No other country in the world is experiencing this. And it just seems to me that oil and gas and the revenues you're getting could overwhelm Guyana.
Well, I don't think it can overwhelm Guyana. What this new wealth is allowing us to do is to create a country that is competitive in all the areas that we have potential in. So for example, Guyana has always been rich in natural resources. We have a lot of raw materials. We have tremendous arable lands and fresh water. We have never been able to be competitive for a number of reasons. The country lacked the infrastructure. Now we are fixing the infrastructure. That is opening up new lands for housing, new lands for agriculture, integrating more Guyana with northern Brazil. So we are building a new highway to integrate northern Brazil. This gives us the possibility of developing a deep water port. So the build out of the country from an infrastructural standpoint, a social standpoint, and importantly, building a healthcare and education system that is second to none is what is important for us. Now, all of these investments are also critical for us to bring back the huge diaspora that migrated during the period of dictatorship.
All right, let's get to the juicy part now. Both, they had a sparring segment, both men, Sacker and Ali, over climate change and Guyana's emergence as a leading producer of oil and gas and what that meant for the environment. Let's get to that and then we can call it quits.
Extractive industries are exploiting our people. And you just sit here
You are placing words that I have not said. I have not said that we're being exploited. I have said that the contract signed by the last government, the contract that was signed by the last government, was heavily skewed to the investor. And we have said that. And I've said to you that as a new government, we cannot unilaterally change that contract.
It's not just, if I may say so, it's not just about the finances, the royalties, the expenses that Exxon demands. It's also about things like insurance. There's an extraordinary case last year in the Guyanan courts where the court decided that your own Environmental Protection Agency and Exxon had failed to provide the necessary guarantees that any oil spill would, in the end, be fully paid for in terms of cleanup by Exxon's parent company.
We have said, and what we are doing, what are we doing to address these issues? Right now, we are drafting, redrafting environmental laws to take care of this. Soon we'll have in
you
the...
You haven't taken care of it, even though the drilling is taking place every single day. If there was a massive oil spill tomorrow, can you tell your own people that Guyana, and indeed the rest of the Caribbean, would be fully recompensed by Exxon?
What I can say is that there are systems in place in the operations of Manuel, operations of Exxon, to take care of this. There are systems in place.
Let's take a big picture look at what's going on here. Over the next decade, two decades, it is expected that there will be $150 billion worth of oil and gas extracted off your coast. It's an extraordinary figure. But think of it in practical terms. That means, according to many experts, more than 2 billion tons of carbon emissions will come from your seabed, from those reserves, and be released into the atmosphere. I don't know if you as a head of state went to the COP in Dubai.
Let me stop you right there. Do you know that Guyana has a forest forever that is the size of England and Scotland combined? A forest that stores 19.5 gigatons of carbon? A forest that we have kept alive? A forest that we have kept alive.
Does that give you the right? Does that give you the right to release all of this carbon?
That give you the right to lecture us on climate change? I am going to lecture you on climate change because we have kept this forest alive that stores 19.5 gigatons of carbon that you enjoy, that the world enjoy, that you don't pay us for, that you don't value, that you don't see a value in, that the people of Guyana has kept alive. Guess what? We have the lowest deforestation rate in the world. And guess what? Even with our greatest exploration of the oil and gas resource we have now, we will still be net zero. Guyana will still be net zero. With all our exploration, still be net zero.
Powerful words, Mr. President.
I'm not completed as yet. I am not finished as yet. I am just not finished as yet. Because this is the hypocrisy that exists in the world. The world in the last 50 years has lost 65% of all its biodiversity. We have kept our biodiversity. Are you valuing it? Are you ready to pay for it? When is the developed world going to pay for it? Or are you in the pockets? Are you in the pockets of those who have damaged the environment? Are you in the pockets? Are you and your system in the pockets of those who destroyed the environment through the Industrial Revolution and now lecturing us? Are you in their pockets? Are you paid by them? Are you paid to keep their message alive? There is no hypocrisy in our position.
The Center for Internet.
Sweet.
Can you imagine? Country get a good stretch of luck after years upon decades of suffering.
Yes.
And I'm just going to put it the white man, tell him, say, no, you're damaging the environment.
Yes. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? You lived there for how long again?
7 years.
7 years.
And trust me, that country needed the development.
Oh my goodness. The man says they're paying 5 cents out of every dollar on debt.
Imagine if Jamaica was in that position.
Oh my goodness gracious me, man. Eh? You'd have about 10 houses.
Where was this consideration from the British and the United States when they were developing their economies based on these heavy fossil fuels? And where is this strength for places like China that uses coal power plants for the majority of their projects? It's so strange that they chose it's quite a large country.
Small population.
A small population, mm-hmm. which is, as he said, heavily forested. You cannot go anywhere in Guyana without running into a rainforest. Yes. It rains constantly. Yes. This is not a place that is so overdeveloped yes. that you have concerns that it's going to collapse under the weight yes. of its industry.
There are no concrete jungles in Guyana. Precisely. There are real jungles.
Precisely.
Yes. I love it. Anyway, people, you know that next week I go to a different slot and Ricardo joins Cliff and Chevron here. I leave it to the gentlemen to decide what to do with your Friday. I can't. Well, I can, but I won't impose.
I see Kirk McCallum in the chat saying that I'm going to be the one who kills him. No, Kirk, I want to keep it alive. Ricardo's the one who wants to kill it. I want to keep it going.
I don't want to impose what they should do. So they'll find their own way. They have their own plans. They'll work it their own way. But I won't be far. And to wrap us up this evening, I spoke about him last week. I want to say good evening. I hope she's listening today. I said to her that I'd mention her on Friday, but we won't have a Friday show. A lady, Gillian Polak. I saw her in the Super Value Center on Constant Spring Road earlier this week. I went to pick up a couple items on the way home, and she was telling me her Roy Shirley story. Yeah, I have to play this song for her and for myself and for the listeners. After this week, check this out now.
Get in the groove, I move those feet, feel good now. I lift and right, east and west. Believe me now. With this blues, the best in sounds. Oh yes, 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 I'm really back in town again to get you on your dancing feet. Oh, let me tell you again, to get you on your dancing feet. Get in the groove, I move those feet, feet cool, feet cool. Believe me, my. Oh, just get move on your dancing feet. I'm moving all night.
Roy Shirley, the high priest, with his classic number, Hold Them. Some people ask you where George is going. I'm going into the morning program. For those of you who, some of these YouTubers treat me as if me just come. I remind you, I started at Nationwide 2005. I left in 2008. I came back in 2010. I left in 2016. And now I'm back. And I've been back since last January. I served from 2014 to 2016. I was morning program, morning radio. Morning man. You know what I mean? I've been through it. I've done it. I have the scars to show. Yeah, I did it. So, yeah, I've hosted Nationwide at 5. I've hosted Nationwide this morning. I've hosted everything. Own program, done left, right, and center with Dennis. I've done everything. The only program I haven't hosted are the gospel programs on the Sunday and Mayor's Parlor. I've hosted you, everything else.
You are this one if you try to do that, though.
No, man. That Mayor theme thing, man. Mayor's thing is Mayor's thing. Yeah? So, Chevron, I hope you keep good traditions. I leave the slate clean for you gentlemen to find your own way. You have the freedom to do it your own way. And we'll continue to make good news and good radio from morning till sundown here on Nationwide 90 FM.
And I'm sure George will be our guest, if of not course. A co-host on yes, this program, man. Many a week. If
yes, man.
And I'm sure we'll invite him back on a Friday.
Of course, invite him, man. Say, man, invite me. Like what you said, you are inviting me back. But of course, you're going to be your place, your show. All right, I want to thank the listeners who've been very supportive. Those on YouTube who've been very supportive as well. All of you have been very supportive. And I remember, I'm one guy who I invite criticism and critique and everything. As long as you don't get ridiculous, I'll have time for you. If you disagree strongly, I encourage that because that's what I want. That's what keeps us on our toes, keeps us at the top of our game. We enjoy that when we embrace that, all right? So, new adventure next week. Siobhan, I want to thank Andrew Anderson. Thanks, Sonia Stewart Perkins dropped. I want to thank Cara Powell in the newsroom. I want to thank all our contributors, all of our reporters. They work so very hard and I'm proud of them. And my name is George Davis.
And I'm Siobhan Campbell. Enjoy your Easter.
You have dreams and goals for the future. You want to make an impact. The UE Mona, the number one ranked university in the Caribbean, will help you reach your full potential. Our students have gone on to make their